وإن تعجب فعجب قولهم أإذا كنا ترابا أإنا لفي خلق جديد أولئك الذين كفروا بربهم وأولئك الأغلال في أعناقهم وأولئك أصحاب النار فيها خالدون.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. أما بعد، أستاذ عبد الرحمن حسن، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
جزاك الله خير for joining me once again on the Hot Seat podcast.
جزاك الله خير for having me.
So we're actually going on a journey, both ourselves and the viewers who are watching this at home, inshallah. And I want to remind the viewers of the journey we've taken. We initially spoke about homosexuality and the LGBTQ movement, and we came to the conclusion that it is not something from Islam. And one of the biggest problems is that the Western countries, where many of our audience live in the UK, US, they are pushing this agenda. The answer for the Muslims came in the second episode, which was to leave these countries, make hijrah, go to the lands of the Muslims. However, we also agreed in the second episode that there are going to be some people who are unable to make hijrah. The question I want to answer today is, what should these people do? How can they rectify the society in the non-Muslim land they're living in? And I want to make that distinction because obviously in a Muslim land with a Muslim ruler, it has its own rules and regulations. I want to be clear that we're talking about a non-Muslim land with a non-Muslim ruler, and you have Muslims living there. How can they fix this society so it's better and it's the best possible outcome for the Muslims who have to remain there? And again, as I always want to do, I want to begin by giving you the opportunity to lay your foundation.
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. The great scholars of Islam, أئمة الهدى ومصابيح الدجى, they mention as a principle which they derived from the Quran and the prophetic Sunnah that تصفية الأحوال في تصفية الأعمال. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to change our situation and the problems and the hardship that we're in, for Allah to remove that subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will be done في تصفية الأعمال, if we rectify our actions. And there are many evidences in the Quran that point towards that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, لَهُ مُعَقِبَاتٌ مِّن بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِ يَحْفَظُونَهُ مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ وَإِذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِقَوْمٍ سُوءًا فَلَا مَرَدَّ لَهُ وَمَا لَهُم مِّن دُونِهِ مِن وَالٍ. In this verse, the part that concerns me now is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ, Allah does not change a situation of a people, حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ, until they first change their situation, their own actions. And Imam Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, a great mufassir, a scholar of tafsir, a great imam, especially he's called Imam al-Mufassirin, the imam of those who do tafsir of the Quran, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. When it came to the tafsir of this verse, he said, يقول تعالى ذكره, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says here, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ مِنْ عَافِيَةٍ وَنِعْمَةٍ فَيُزِيلُ ذَلِكَ عَنْهُمْ وَيُهْلِكَهُمْ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ مِنْ ذَلِكَ بِظُلْمِ بَعْضِهِمْ بَعْضًا وَاعْتِدَاءِ بَعْضِهِمْ بَعْضًا فَتَحِلَّ بِهِمْ حِينَئِذٍ عُقُوبَتَهُ وَتَغْيِيرَهُ. Ibn Jarir rahimahullah, he says that Allah does not change a situation of a people who are upon health and they have blessings and bliss. Allah doesn't remove that from them, that blessing that they have, the health that they have, the good that they have. Allah does not remove that from them and does not bring them destruction and hardship and anarchy, except when they change their own actions. And then he mentioned some of the things that people can do that brings about Allah's punishments. He says, بِظُلْمِ بَعْضِهِمْ بَعْضًا, when they oppress one another. وَاَعْتِدَاءِ بَعْضِهِمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ, and when some of them exceed their limits and their boundaries regarding one another. Then he said, فَتَحِلَّ بِهِمْ حِينَئِذٍ عُقُوبَتَهُ وَتَغِيرَهُ. Then and only then does the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala come, and does it then destroy them. So for us to have a better situation, we first of all have to change our actions. Also, Ibn Abi Hatim mentions in his tafsir, Ibn Jarir al-Tabri brings this as well, and also Ibn Kathir transmits it from Ibn Abi Hatim, that Ibrahim al-Nakha'i, the great tabi'i, he mentioned something which relates to the question that you just asked, and also relates to the verse that I read, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Ibrahim al-Nakha'i, he said, أَوْحَى اللَّهُ إِلَى نَبِيٍّ مِنْ أَنْبِيَاءِ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. Allah sent a revelation on a prophet from the early prophets that came before Nabi Muhammad, the prophets of Bani Israel. What did Allah say to them? أَنْقُلْ لِقَوْمِكَ, say to your people. That prophet was told to say to his people, إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِ قَرْيَةٍ وَلَا أَهْلِ بَيْتٍ يَكُونُونَ عَلَى طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ فَيَتَحَوَّلُونَ مِنْهَا إِلَى مَعْصِيَةِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا تَحَوَّلَ لَهُمْ مِمَّا يُحِبُّونَ إِلَى مَا يَكْرَهُونَ. ثُمَّ قَالَ إِنَّ مِسْتَاقَ ذَلِكَ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُوا مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Ibrahim al-Nakha'i, he said that this prophet was told to say to his people that there is not a people of a village or a town, people who live in their houses or residents in their own places, their towns, their villages, and they leave off, or they are upon the obedience of Allah. And these people of the village or the people of this house are upon obedience, and then they leave that. One day they choose, you know what? Let's do something different. Let's try to keep up with the world. So, فَيَتَحَوَّلُونَ مِنْهَا إِلَى مَعْصِيَةِ اللَّهِ. They turn away from the obedience of Allah and they go towards the disobedience of Allah. إِلَّا تَحَوَّلَ لَهُمْ مِمَّا يُحِبُّونَ إِلَى مَا يَكْرَهُونَ. Except what will happen to them is the blessing that they had, the ni'am of Allah that they had, because they changed their situation, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will change their situation and the way that they are and the way that He will deal with them, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَمْ يَكُوا مُغَيِّرًا نِعْمَةً أَنْعَمَهَا عَلَى قُومٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُوا مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. Allah is not one who changes a blessing that He blesses upon a people until they change their situation, they change their actions. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is one that hears everything that the slaves say. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has knowledge of everything. So the blessings that people have, that they've been given, Allah will remove it subhanahu wa ta'ala the minute they become disobedient. Allah said to Quraysh, because Allah gave Quraysh everything that they wanted and everything they needed, and Allah reminded them, do you want this blessing to remain? فَلْيَعْبُدُوا رَبَّ هَذَا الْبَيْتِ. Worship the Lord of this Kaaba. Yani bayt here means the Kaaba. Worship that Lord. Yani worship him alone. Don't associate partners with him. فَلْيَوَحِدُوا. Let them single Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in worship. رب هذا البيت, the Lord of this house, the Kaaba. Why? Because He's the one الذي أطعمهم من جوع وآمنهم من خوف. Allah تبارك وتعالى, He provided from them when they were poor and they were in need. He provided for them سبحانه وتعالى وآمنهم من خوف. And Allah تبارك وتعالى, He took from them. The thing with Quraysh is that Quraysh, all of the other tribes, their merchants, their belongings were all stolen. If they tried to go through one village to another, like in Quraysh could move their product from one spot to another spot and no one would touch it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in another ayah, وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا قَرْيَةً كَانَتْ آمِنَةً مُطْمَئِنَّةً يَأْتِيهَا رِزْقُهَا رَغَدًا مِنْ كُلِّ مَكَانٍ فَكَفَرَتْ بِأَنْعُمِ اللَّهِ فَأَذَاقَهَا اللَّهُ لِبَأْسَ الْجُوعِ وَالْخَوْفِ بِمَا كَانُوا يَصْنَعُونَ. Allah talks about a village, a town, and this village and town is Mecca. كَانَتْ آمِنَةً, safe, مُطْمَئِنَّةً, tranquility. يَأْتِيهَا رِزْقُهَا رَغَدًا مِنْ كُلِّ مَكَانٍ. The blessings of Allah was coming from every direction. Allah then says, فَكَفَرَتْ بِأَنْعُمِ اللَّهِ. These people, they expressed disbelief of Allah's blessings. فَأَذَاقَهَا اللَّهُ لِبَأْسَ الْجُوعِ وَالْخَوْفِ بِمَا كَانُوا يَصْنَعُونَ. Allah brought about what? Allah brought about hunger and poverty. And Allah brought them fear. At the ending of the ayah, Allah says, بِمَا كَانُوا يَصْنَعُونَ, because of that which they did. Now those verses were depending on people who had blessings, and the blessing was removed and hardship was brought to them. There are verses which are clear for people who Allah is saying to them, if you want anything from me, you have to be upright and steadfast. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He said, وَأَلَّا وِاسْتَقَامُوا عَلَى الطَّرِيقَةِ لَأَسْقَيْنَاهُمْ مَاءً غَدَقًا. Had the deniers, and those who denied Nabi Muhammad's message, had they followed the right way, we would have certainly granted them abundant rain to drink. يعني ما أن غدقا means we would have given them. The word here ما أن غدقا is a representation. I mean, it refers to Allah will give them blessings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring them rizq. Imam al-Baghawi and other great scholars mentioned that. ولذلك Baghawi mentions, he says, يعني لو استقاموا, if they were steadfast على طريقة الحق, يعني if the disbelievers were to come to the true path, والإيمان والإيمان والهدى, they came to Iman and they came to guidance, فكانوا مؤمنين مطيعين, they obeyed Allah and they became faithful to Allah. Allah says, أسقيناهم ماء غدقا. Now this refers to the West. Allah is saying to them, subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you believe and you come with this religion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you guys blessings. Allah says in another ayah, وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَهْلَ الْقُرَىٰ آمَنُوا وَاتَّقَوْا لَفَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ بَرَكَاتٍ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَلَكِنْ كَذَّبُوا فَأَخَذْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. Allah says, if the people of the village were to believe, آمَنُوا وَاتَّقَوْا, and they came with taqwa and piety, Allah says, لَفَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ بَرَكَاتٍ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ, Allah says, I will open the sky, rain will come down for them. والأرض, and the earth, Allah will make that rain when it comes down from the sky, Allah will make that rain produce crops. يعني some rain is not actually a blessing, it's actually a punishment. The people of Nuh were destroyed because of a rain. But this rain, Allah is saying, I will send on these people who came with iman and taqwa. It's a rain that will make the earth produce. ولكن كذبوا, but they chose to disbelieve. فأخذناهم بما كانوا يكسبون. Allah says, we grabbed them because of what they did, not because Allah is being just to them. Iman is not something we just claim. Iman is something we come with. ليس الإيمان بالتحلي ولا بالتمني ولكن ما وقر في القلب وصدقه العمل. As Hassan al-Basri said, he said, Iman is not just a mere claim, wishful thinking. Iman is something that settles in the heart and then the actions of the person shows.
I want to press you on something here because I really try my best to give you the opening introduction and not interrupt you. But I feel like this isn't relevant to our discussion. And the reason I say that is for two reasons. You've brought many evidences that show that if people are in a state of goodness and they don't appreciate their blessings, Allah will turn that state of goodness into a state of maybe fear, maybe poverty. And that makes sense because Allah is not unjust. He's not going to do that unjustly. It's if the people themselves don't appreciate their blessings, then that will happen. The second half, you actually brought ayat and evidences to prove that if the non-Muslims, if they came to Islam, then Allah would bless them with things from the dunya, like rain, like rizq, all of these things. I'm not talking about the non-Muslims. I'm talking about Muslims in the West who are in a bad, difficult situation. The government is imposing homosexuality on them in their schools. How do these guys get out of that if they don't have the ability to leave the country? That's what I want to talk about.
Shahid. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا آمِنُوا. Those of you who believe, believe. Allah is commanding the believers to believe. Because in our belief, his aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah is that إيمان يزيد بالطاعة وينقص بالمعصية. The iman yazidu bit-ta'a wa yanqusu bil-ma'siya. The iman increases and it decreases. ولذلك, when Allah is saying to the people of the scripture, وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ آمَنُوا وَاتَّقَوْا لَكَفَرْنَا عَنْهُمْ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ وَلَأَدْخَلْنَاهُمْ جَنَّاتِ النَّعِيمِ وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ أَقَامُوا التَّوْرَاةَ وَالْإِنْجِيلَ وَمَا أُنْزِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ لَأَكَلُوا مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ وَمِنْ تَحْتِ أَرْجُلِهِمْ مِنْهُمْ أُمَّةٌ مُقْتَصِدَةٌ وَكَثِيرٌ مِنْهُمْ سَاءَ مَا يَعْمَلُونَ. Allah is saying the people of the scripture, if they were to believe, that's not only talking to the people of the scripture. The qa'ida in the tafsir of the Quran is al-ibratu bi'umumi al-lafzi la bi-khususi sabab. When Allah said to the Prophet, Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu taqillah, is Allah only referring to the Prophet here?
No.
He's commanding everybody to have taqwa. So when Allah said, وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَهْلَ الْقُرَىٰ وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ آمَنُوا, if the people of the scripture were to believe, وَاتَّقَوْا, and they came with taqwa, لَكَفَّرْنَا عَنْهُمْ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ, we will expiate for them their shortcomings. وَلَأَدْخَلْنَاهُمْ جَنَّاتِ النَّعِيمِ, the day of judgment, Allah says, I'll put them into Jannah. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ أَقَامُوا التَّوْرَاةِ, if they established the Torah. وَالْإِنْجِيلَ, and they established the Injil. وَمَا أُنْزِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ, and they established what was sent on them, يعني the Quran, some of the Mufassirin mentioned. لَأَكَلُوا مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ, they would eat from high above.
So you're saying these ayat, even though they're directed to the people of the book, to the non-believers, they apply to the Muslims as well?
Of course it does.
That's fine. Let's take that. I agree with you. Even then, you've told me that the benefits that they get from increasing their iman, increase the faith, are dunyawi benefits. Rizq, water.
No, like I said, mentioned, وَلَأَدْخَلْنَاهُمْ جَنَّاتِ النَّعِيمِ.
That's in the akhir. But how are they going to help their situation in their land? They don't need this rizq because that's the reason they're in the West. They've got plenty of that. The issue for them is how do they counter the attacks that the government are putting on them?
Rizq is not just food. That's the understanding that, you know, I think you're having here. You only think rizq is only food.
What else is it?
Rizq is Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Yani rizq, is a very comprehensive term. It's a very comprehensive term. Children are rizq. To give you righteous children is a rizq from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And when Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he's saying, fear Allah will take away from the believers. ضرب الله مثلا قرية كانت آمنة مطمئنة يأتيها رزق ورغدا من كل مكان فكفرت بأنعم الله فأذاقها الله لباس الجوع والخوف بما كانوا يصنعون. The ayah is talking about fear will be taken from them. And if a group of people are living in a state of fear and poverty, they can't think. We know the famous hadith of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, where he mentioned, he said, ibadah at the time of haraj, ibadah at the time of fitan, the Prophet said, it's like a hijratin ilayya, it's like migrating to me. Why specifically ibadah at the time of the fitna? Because times of fitan, the brains have gone. Trials and tribulations, when it hits, it's hard to focus. That's what Allah is saying, فَلْيَعْبُدُوا رَبَّ هَذَا الْبَيْتِ, worship the Lord of this house. الَّذِي أَطْعَمَهُم مِّن جُوعٍ, the time when there's hunger, you can't think properly. وَآمَنَهُمْ مِنْ خَوْفٍ, when you're scared and you're worried for yourself, you can't, the concept of ibadah becomes very hard. Allah is saying, I reassured you with all of those. I promised you, I'm taking care of your safety. I'm taking care of your provision. Just worship me. This is not only for Quraysh, it's for the believers as well. إِبْتِدَاءً. ولذلك Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, قُلْ يَا أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ لَسْتُمْ عَلَى شَيْءٍ حَتَّى تُقِيمَ التَّوْرَاةَ وَالْإِنْجِيلَ وَمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُم مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. If you are the people of the scripture, Muslims, Christians, Jews, all of you guys, لَسْتُمْ عَلَى شَيْءٍ, you are upon nothing until you establish Tawrat وَالْإِنْجِيلَ. And Tawrat and Injil pointed towards Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُم مِّن رَبِّكُمْ, and that which has been sent to you from your Lord, يعني the Quran. Allah then says, وَلَيَزِيدَنَّ كَثِيرًا مِّنْهُمْ مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ مِّن رَبِّكَ طُغْيَانًا وَكُفْرًا فَلَا تَأْسَ عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. If they establish the Quran and they come with what the Quran commands them, Allah is saying, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he's going to make sure that he takes care of them. The Muslims in the West need that today. That's what we're dying for. That's what we're looking for. We want hardship and the struggles that we're going through for Allah to remove it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Humiliation is upon us right now. In many places in the world, as Muslims, we're suffering. Abu Dawud narrated in his Sunan, and also Ahmad narrated in his Musnad, on the authority of Ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِذَا تَبَايَعْتُمْ بِالْعِينَةِ, when the people start to trade a form, يعني, there's a type of trading which is called عِينَة. عِينَة is a trading which is riba in reality, but they cloak it with bay'a.
Okay.
They cloak it in a form of يعني, bay'a, which is halal. So they make it a form of bay'a, buying and selling, but reality, the essence of this is what? It's riba. The Prophet said, إِذَا تَبَايَعْتُمْ بِالْعِينَةِ, if you guys start doing عِينَة, which is this riba, وَأَخَذْتُمْ أَذْنَابَ الْبَقَرِ وَرَضِيْتُمْ بِالزَّرْعِ, and you grab onto the tails of the cows, and you become pleased with the agricultures. Again, representation of what? Running after dunya, giving yourselves to the dunya. وَتَرَكْتُمُ الْجِهَادَ, and you leave off fighting for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether it be jihad al-nafs, or whether it be jihad السلاح, يعني the way that the sharia set. صَلَّطَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ ذُلَّا لَا يَنْزِعُ حَتَّى تَرْجِعُ إِلَىٰ دِينِكُمْ, Allah will place upon you humiliation until you come back to your religion. Look at the last part of the hadith. صَلَّطَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ ذُلَّا, Allah will place upon you Muslims ذُلَّا, humility. لَا يَنْزِعُهُ, Allah will not remove that humility from you, حَتَّى تَرْجِعُ إِلَىٰ دِينِكُمْ, until you come back to your religion. Another riwayah explained what it means to come back to your religion, because a lot of Muslims be like, yeah, I'm doing what my religion calls me to. A riwayah in Musnad, it says, حَتَّى تَرْجِعُ إِلَىٰ مَا كُنْتُمْ عَلَيْهِ, until you come back to that which you were upon. Again, another group of people might say, what does that mean? Tabarani narrated it even more clearly. He said, حَتَّى تَرْجِعُ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِكُمُ الْأَوَّلِ, until you come back to the affairs of the beginning. يعني, until you come back to what Muhammad was upon. A religion that's not tainted. A religion that's not filled with يعني, bid'ah and يعني, innovation and all of that. And it's pure, it's clean. The way it was upon for Nabi Muhammad, then you're going to find it. Shahid, you can never bring me in history, historically. في عالمنا, the world that we live in today, this alam that we're living in today, someone who came with what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with in just 23 years of his life. His path, without a doubt, countries, it takes them centuries and they don't even reach what he reached. Alayhi salatu wasalam. And there was a method he took. Abu Sulaiman al-Darani said something very powerful. He said, "Man safa sufiya lahu, wa man kaddara kuddira alayhi, wa man ahsana fi nahari kufiya fi laylihi, wa man ahsana fi laylihi kufiya fi nahari." Anyone who is pure and is clean in his actions, Allah will make your outer and the reality around you and the world that you live in, Allah will make it better for you. And anyone who taints his actions with filth and disobedience, Allah will taint everything around you and your life and everything will become bad. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنَ فِي نَهَارِهِ Anyone who is good in his daytime, كُوْفِئَ فِي لَيْلِهِ Allah will take care of your night. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنَ فِي لَيْلِهِ Anyone who is good at night and prays and remembers Allah at night, كُوْفِئَ فِي نَهَارِهِ Allah will take over your affairs daytime. There are reasons why Muslims are being humiliated. It's not what many people are being told. The reason why many Muslims are being humiliated are as follows. Number one, مُحَادَاتُ لِلَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ Defying Allah and His Messenger. The people are going against what Allah and His Messenger sanctioned. That's why Allah said in the ayah, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُحَادُّونَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ أُولَٰئِكَ فِي الْأَذَلِّينَ Ponder on that verse. Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ the ones يُحَادُّونَ اللَّهَ that are defying Allah and His Messenger, opposing Allah and His Messenger, أُولَٰئِكَ فِي الْأَذَلِّينَ ما معنى في الأذلين؟ أذلين means humiliated. They're the ones Allah تبارك وتعالى is going to put down. There's the one going to be Allah is going to forsake subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is something we have to understand. Muhadatullahi wa rasuli. Going against Allah and His Messenger is what makes a people lose. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He said, وَأَرَادُوا بِهِ كَيْدًا فَجْعَلْنَاهُمُ الْأَخْسَرِينَ Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He was talking about Ibrahim. Imagine someone was thrown into the fire. Ibrahim was thrown into the fire. Allah says, وَأَرَادُوا بِهِ كَيْدًا They planned against Ibrahim alayhi salam. When they planned against him, who became the one that was lost? Who was the one humiliated? Not Ibrahim. Allah says, فَجَعَلْنَاهُمُ الْأَخْسَرِينَ In another place, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He said, one place Allah said, وَأَرَادُوا بِهِ كَيْدًا فَجَعَلْنَاهُمُ الْأَخْسَرِينَ Allah says in another place, فَأَرَادُوا بِهِ كَيْدًا فَجَعَلْنَاهُمُ الْأَسْفَلِينَ Allah made them the lower one. Why? They can plan and plot against you as much as they like. If you have a good bond with Allah Azza wa Jalla, you have a good bond with Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, the fire that's meant to burn, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala told us, He said to the fire, كُونِ بَرْدًا وَسَلَامًا عَلَى Ibrahim. The fire Allah spoke to it. That's a makhluk min makhlukati Allah Azza wa Jalla. It's a creation from the creation of Allah. Allah told the fire, don't burn Ibrahim.
Okay. I want to interject now and I want to get into the discussion. I've given you enough time to lay your foundation, lay your introduction. And what I'm understanding from that is the hypothesis that you're putting forward is that the Muslims in the West who are being humiliated, we agree on that, who are finding it difficult to practice their faith in their country, we agree on that. The solution for them, if they can't leave, which obviously is the number one solution, but if they can't leave, then is to build their relationship with Allah. And as a result of that, Allah will make their situation easy. Have I understood your hypothesis correctly?
I wouldn't like to use the word hypothesis, but this is in Nusus Wahiyin. I mentioned Quran and Sunnah. So it's a fact, it's a reality.
Okay. I'm not going to bang my head against those evidences that you brought forward. And I'll agree with you that we need to change the condition of the Muslims in the West. My theory and the theory I'd like to put forward to you today is the best, most practical way to do that is by changing the laws and regulations coming from the government while making it extremely hard for Muslims to practice their religion. Change those to give an environment for the Muslims who can't leave the West to make it easy for them to practice their religion. And I feel that's a much more practical solution than quoting examples from Ibrahim alayhi salam when Allah made the fire cool for him, or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what he was able to do. We're never going to be able to replicate that. Let's be honest, let's stick to the real world, the 21st century. In the West, why don't we influence the government whilst not compromising on our religion, but influence the government to bring rules and laws and regulations that make it easy for the Muslims to practice their deen? Isn't that surely the way forward?
No, Shahid, that's really not the way forward for the Muslims. To start from the top and come down is not the right way. It's not the prophetic way, by the way.
Why? How can you say that?
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith, Ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrated, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, بُعُثُ بَيْنَ يَدَيِ السَّاعَةِ بِالسَّيْفِ حَتَّى يُعْبَدَ اللَّهُ وَحَدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَجُعْلَ رِزْقِي تَحْتَ ذِلِّ رُمْحِي وَجُعْلَ الذُّلُّ وَالصَّغَارُ عَلَى مَنْ خَالَفَ أَمْرِي وَمَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ The part that really concerns the hadith Imam Ahmad narrated in his Musnad, min hadith Ibn Umar, the Prophet ﷺ, here he said And it's the part I want us to focus on and really understand it and digest it. This is where the crux of the whole entire discussion goes back to, which is the Prophet's statement here where he says, وَجُعِلَ الذُّلُّ وَالصَّغَارُ عَلَى مَنْ خَالَفَ أَمْرِي. Humiliation and belittling is for the one who opposes my command. Then the Prophet said after that, وَمَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. Anyone who imitates a people is from them. I'm going to mention to you a hadith that's going to clarify for you the way that things were for the Prophet ﷺ. As we know, the Prophet lived in Mecca. And he lived in Mecca for 13 years of his life after being a prophet. From the age of 40 to 53, he was in Mecca ﷺ. And Quraysh harmed the Messenger ﷺ severely. There's a story Ibn Ishaq mentions in his seerah. Ibn Ishaq mentions this in his seerah. He says, Utbah ibn al-Rabi'ah, and Utbah ibn al-Rabi'ah wa kana sayyidan, he was a sayyid of his people. He one day came, wa huwa jalisu fi nadi Quraysh. He came to the assembly of Quraysh. And he said to them, Quraysh, and they were sitting there. He said, Quraysh. And Amir Muhammad, by the way, was in the masjid, yani the Bayt, the Kaaba, praying. So he came to Quraysh and he said to them, Ya ma'ashar Quraysh, oh Quraysh, ala aqumu ila Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, fa'ukallima. Why should I not go to Muhammad? What do you guys think? Should I go to Muhammad and I speak to him? وَأَعْرِضْ عَلَيْهِ أُمُورًا لَعَلَّهُ يَقْبَلَ بَعْضَهَا فَنُعْطِيَهُ أَيَّهَا شَاءَ. And when I speak to him, I'm going to present things to him, which he might accept from us. وَيَكُفَّ عَنَّا, and some of it he might reject. But it's a chance for us to have a dialogue with him and talk to him. This, by the way, this was when حين أسلم حمزة. This is when Hamza took Islam. And they're now, it's worrying. Now, they're losing يعني, strong individuals. And so he came to Nabi Muhammad. When he came to the Prophet ﷺ, he said to him, so Quraysh said to him, go and speak to him. Quraysh, they said, now go and speak to him. If you think that's going to work, then go do it. They've given up now. They can see they're losing grip of the community. Nabi Muhammad is getting publicity. The people are coming and following him, ﷺ, the truth that he's coming with. So they said, قُمْ إِلَيْهِ فَكَلِّمُ, go and speak to him if that's going to change anything. So Utbah ibn Rabi'ah stood up and he went to the Prophet ﷺ. When he came to the Prophet, he said to Yabna Akhi, the son of my brother, my nephew, إِنَّكَ مِنَّا, you are from us. You're a man from amongst us. حَيْثُ قَدْ عَلِمْتَ مِنَ السِّطَّةِ فِي الْعَشِيرَةِ, you know the position you hold in the community. And you're from a big tribe, you're Quraysh, you're Bani Hashim, and you're one of us. وَالْمَكَانَ فِي النَّسَبِ, the lineage and the community, you're a big figure, you're not a man who's nothing like that. وَإِنَّكَ قَدْ أَتَيْتَ قَوْمَكَ بِأَمْرٍ عَظِيمٍ, you've come with a great issue. فَرَّقْتَ بِهِمْ جَمَاعَتَهُمْ, you've caused discord and disunity amongst the community. Uproar. But a son and a father are not talking anymore. You are causing havoc. وَسَفَّحْتَ بِهِمْ أَحْلَامَهُمْ, and what you've also done is, you've kind of spoken bad about their fathers and their forefathers. وَعِبْتَ بِهِمْ أَلِهَتَهُمْ, you've belittled their fathers and said their fathers are in hellfire. And you've now insulted their idols and you've given it names and said, this is wrong. وَدِينَهُمْ, their religion. وَكَفَّرْتَ بِهِ مَنْ مَضَى مِنْ آبَائِهِمْ, فَاسْمَعْ مِنِّي, listen to me. After all of that which you've done, listen to me, Muhammad. أَعْرِضْ عَلَيْكَ أُمُورًا, I have a proposal for you. I'm going to give you something. Then the Prophet ﷺ said to him, hey, what is it here? قُلْ يَا أَبَا وَلِيدْ, present to me what you think you want to say. I'll listen to you. He said, يَا بْنَ أَخِي, إِن كُنْتَ إِنَّمَا تُرِيدُ بِمَا جِئْتَ بِهِ, if what you have brought forward, you're looking for, the intent behind this message that you're coming with is مَالًا, wealth. جَمَعْنَا لَكَ مِنْ أَمْوَالِنَا حَتَّى تَكُونَ أَكْثَرَنَا مَالًا, we will gather all of our wealth. From every tribe, we'll say this much give, we'll give it all to you. We will make you the richest man in Mecca. خلاص. وَإِن كُنْتَ تُرِيدُ بِهِ شَرَفًا, if you're looking for honor, reputation, dignity, سَوَّدْنَاكَ عَلَيْنَا, we'll make you our leader. حَتَّى لَا نَقْطَعَ أَمْرًا دُونَكَ, to extend that you're going to make the decision, we're just going to follow you. وَإِن كُنْتَ تُرِيدُ بِهِ مُلْكًا مَلَّكْنَاكَ عَلَيْنَا, if what you're looking for is kingdom, that you take it and your children take it and it's inherited like that, it's just long term, we will do that for you. He went on. حَتَّى إِذَا فَرَغَ عُتْبَةً, عُتْبَةً finished what he wanted to say. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said to him, أَقَدْ فَرَغْتَ يَا أَبَا الْوَلِيدِ, أَبَا وَلِيدِ, have you finished what you wanted to say? يعني عُتْبَةً, have you finished what you wanted to say? He said, نعم, I did. فاسمع مني, the Prophet said, listen to me now. عُتْبَةً said, okay, أفعل, I will listen to you. He said to him, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, حاميم تنزيل من الرحمن الرحيم كتاب فصلت آياته قرآن عربي لقوم يعلمون بشيرا ونذيرا فأعرض أكثرهم فهم لا يسمعون وقالوا قلوبنا فيه أكنة مما تدعون إليه. Recited those verses, the Prophet. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam carried on reading. Utbah was listening attentively to him, not talking, not saying anything, until the Prophet reached a prostration and he prostrated alayhi salatu wasalam, and the Prophet raised his head up from the prostration. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to Utbah, قَدْ سَمِعْتَ يَا أَبَا الْوَلِيدِ, you've heard what I wanted to say. مَا سَمِعْتَ, that which I've said. فَأَنْتَ وَذَاكَ, and that is what's upon you. And the Prophet stood up and he left. Shahid. Quraysh presented to Nabiullahi Muhammad power. They presented everything to him. They said, here it is, it's all yours. We will listen to you. You go to the top. The Prophet could have said, as many of Muslims are thinking today, he could have said, I go to the top and I'll get everything corrected.
At what cost? What did they want from him in return?
That specific narration I told you, حَتَّى لَا نَقَطَعُ أَمْرًا دُونَكَ, we will listen to everything you say.
There was no compromise of the religion.
In that narration specifically.
Are there other supporting narrations about the same incident that you mentioned?
Other narrations do mention a more powerful understanding. I want you to hear and understand it. After Quraysh did that to the Prophet and they saw he's not giving up, this is not what he's looking for. Shahid, 2 points. The politics today, it's going to take from your religion.
Not necessarily.
Anyone who, look, let me explain something to you. Jamaluddin, this concept of the activism now that we're seeing today, that's running like that.
Yeah.
The first person it goes back to is not the early scholars of Islam and honor. It goes back to a man by the name of Jamaluddin al-Afghani, mubtadi', a deviated individual. Jamaluddin al-Afghani, this concept he came with, and he propagated it, that the Muslims have to be part of politics, wa ma ila dhalik. After him, adopted it, his student Muhammad Abduh. Muhammad Abduh said, you know what, you're right, my sheikh is right, took it from him. And he adopted it and pushed it and spoke for it and argued for it until when he realized that politics is not going to work for him. He spent years of his life. He said, one of the things that being transmitted from him, he said, Majalatul Manar, Muhammad Rashid Ridha mentions it. He says, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min lafzi siyasa. وَمِنْ يَعَنِي مَكَانٍ يُلْفَضُ فِيهِ السِّيَاسَةِ, oh, Allah, seek refuge in the word siyasa, the place where siyasa is mentioned. وَمِنْ سَاسَ وَيَسُوسُ وَسَائِسِ, I hate the word, the root word, where it's derived from. يعني نِقْمَ شَدِيدَ, he became very, 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 very upset with politics. He realized it's going to harm you. It's not going to give you. After him took Muhammad Rashid Ridha. Muhammad Abdu and Jamal al-Din al-Afghani are misguided people. لكن Muhammad Rashid Ridha was a man that somehow had a different approach. He believed in this political thing. He believed in it. He had a belief of calling to Tawheed as well. MashaAllah, strengthening the people's Tawheed, calling to the Sunnah. He was doing all of that.
Mm-hmm.
But even him, because of politics, he adopted, he took on board principles, because politics works on that, which is قَاعِدَةُ نَتَعَوَنُ فِي مَتَفَقْنَا عَلَيْهِ وَيَعْضُرُ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضًا فِي مَخْتَلَفْنَا فِيهِ. We work with each other on what we agree upon, and we will excuse each other on what we differ upon.
Yeah.
A principle which then brings the LGBT, the homosexuals, all of us put our differences aside, has no limits, yeah? Because when وَيَعْضُرُ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضًا, we will excuse one another in what we differ upon, has no limitations. And there's no point, it stops, the qa'id is like that. So the disbeliever, the atheist, agnostic, as long as we have the same goal, we work together on that. This is what politics is. This Qa'id al-Shaytaniya, as Ibn al-Uthaymeen called it, is that's where it's taken from. That's where it came from, people who had to do this because of politics and activism. So you find a person having to do shirki rituals, not because he believes in it. It's not him. It's not his personal qana'a nafsiya, that he's personal content with. It's not him. Maidan al-Siyasa, this is what politics does to you. It destroys the division between Tawheed and shirk. Sunnah and bid'ah. That's why you see people who work with innovators and everything is adopted from that. Look at in the UK, we have Conservative Party on one side, we have the Labour Party. With their differences, they still work together on issues and some laws.
But so did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he even advocated it.
But never did he say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let's put our differences aside. He refuted their differences.
And we don't have to necessarily put our differences aside, but it doesn't mean, I'm not talking about, by the way, someone wrote, like trying to become an MP in the UK and trying to go through the political party route. But there is an argument for Muslims to get a bit more actively engaged, because if you sit back and do nothing, which is what your proposal is, and not, sorry, that's not fair, because you're not just proposing to do nothing, you're proposing to teach books in the masajid to correct the people from the ground up.
Shahid, what I'm saying is that Muslims getting power and reaching that level that we all want. By the way, we're all saying that inshallah ta'ala, we want Muslims to be the strongest, the up. But we're saying it doesn't come about by starting from the top and going down. No, it doesn't work like that. It works the opposite way. The community, build your community. Have a strong community. يعني, the scholars, they say, Al-Khilafah thamarah min thamarati tawheed. The concept of khilafah, it comes from tawheed. Remember what I said to you before. Nabi Muhammad, when he refused Utbah ibn Rabi'ah's offer and Quraysh and what they had to bring to the table. Shahid, Nabi Muhammad, after that, what did he do? And what was his approach that he took? And how did he go about it? So he turned this down and he left them. He could still ask other people to give it to him. If there's like, and some Muslims say today, for example, they say that the reason the Prophet refused that was because there was a condition that he didn't want. No, after that, look what happened. Nabi Muhammad, every year he would go to the Hajj and he would go to the Mawasim, the place where the people come. He would go to Majanna and Uqar. There's markets, the big markets where everybody's gathering. This is Hajj. Hajj is the most, you know how Hajj is now. It was like that for them as well. People would come from everywhere. The Prophet will go to Majanna, he will go to Uqadha, he will go to Mina. And just look what he say. He would say, Man yu'wini, who's going to give me shelter? Man yansuruni, who's going to give me victory in my message? Hatta ubelligha risalati rabbi. So I can convey the message of my Lord, walahul jannah. And he's going to receive jannah. Shahid, ponder here and contemplate. He didn't say, who's going to give me victory so I can be the leader or I can get in power. He didn't. He said, Hatta ubelligha risalati rabbi.
Yeah, but Ustaz, I'm not saying people have to get in power. I don't know why it has to be this or that. They're not mutually exclusive.
Yeah, one you takes can, away from the other.
No,
Shahid.
It doesn't. You can teach the people from the ground Shahid, up the way
does.
You want to do.
It does.
The way you want to do, teach the people. But at the same time, why can't we not get into power? I'm not saying that I want a Muslim prime minister to get into power or anything like that. I'm not taking it that far. I'm saying, why can't we just lobby the governments? Just show them that we are a minority that has a big voice in the UK. And when we come together...
Yeah, but your people are not even... Shahid, that's what I'm saying. When you strengthen your community, you would tend to get a voice, an agreement amongst the community. You have a community that's united, that's come together on fundamental issues. That's when you're in the masjid and you're teaching, you bring the people together. Then we will work towards something. Our community have lost their religion. Our community are divided amongst themselves. Yani Shahid, let me say something to you. We've seen all of this and we've lived through all of it. When Mursi, for example, came into power, this is a mithal, good example.
Okay.
Who Mursi came into power. Okay. He's now seen as a figurehead who's now governing in the country. He came through the system in the most pleasing way to the West. He got elected through voting. And that's the first time ever Egypt has ever had it. Ever. He came into power. He's now in power. The man is in power. Shahid, because the community and the society were not ready, yani they were not nurtured correctly. They were the same people who went against him. The people were used against him. Shahid, there were prophets of Islam, Nabi and Biya, who lived under rulers, when they never went into power. Prophets were living under these people. Even the closest person they use is Yusuf alayhi salam. Nabiullah Yusuf, he didn't lobby towards power. It was offered to him and he accepted it.
Which shows that it's not necessarily a bad thing to be in power.
No, I'm not saying
he accepted it.
No, I'm not saying it's not, and in no shape or form am I. I'm saying the approach and the methods that is being taken in order to look for it, it's not right. That's not what Islam. Look, Ibrahim alayhi salam, Yusuf alayhi salam, when the man put him in power, وَقَالَ الْمَلِكُ أُتُونِي بِهِ أَسْتَخْلِصُ لِنَفْسِي, the leader said, call me for him, after he interpreted the dream. And he called to Tawheed in prison. He called them to what? أَرْبَابُ مُتَفَرِّقُونَ خَيْرُ أَمِ اللَّهُ. And he was conversing with them about Tawheed. He said, first, I won't even interpret the dream. He told him the tawheed, solidifies that in their hearts, told him about that. And then after that, he told him, if you go out, then tell the leader that I am a free man and this accusation is false. The man went and told the interpretation of the dream to the Malik. The Malik then said, "Ituni bihi, bring this man to me. Astakhlisu li nafsi, I'm going to bring this man close to me so I can converse with him and get his advice. So I'm going to give him something, a position, in order for him to talk to me. فلما كلمه, when he spoke to him, قال إنك اليوم لدينا مكين أمين. When he spoke to Yusuf alayhi salam, he said to Yusuf, today you are to us a man who's reliable. You're not, I'm freeing your name from the accusation that was given against you. And Yusuf wanted that first to clear. Then look what he said. When he said to him, you are a reliable person to us, and we are today going to, I'm going to make you under me. Yani, astakhlisu li nafsi means you're going to be somebody who's going to do something for me. Yusuf could have chosen the highest of levels. What did he ask for? He asked for the Ministry of Finance. He said, قَالِ جَعَلْنِي عَلَىٰ خَزَائِنِ الْأَرْضِ إِنِّي حَفِيظٌ عَلِيمٌ. If you're going to give me a role, and that's what you're presenting to me, I'll take the Ministry of Finance. Keeping in mind, Yusuf is working under a non-Muslim. If the idea is to get into power and overtake everything, Yusuf's now been presented this position. And the leader, by the way, is doing this right now because he's been foretold that there's going to come there's going to come qahd to the people. Yani, people are going to go through drought and hunger and poverty is coming the way. So they need somebody to take them out of this. And Yusuf alayhi salam specifically chose a place where he can help them on that issue. My point to you is, Anbiya and Rusul, there's going to come a prophet the day of judgment and there's nobody with him. Nabiullah Muhammad alayhi salam set us an example. Shahid, who brings leadership? Who brings Muslims in power? Our efforts and our lobbying are running around? No. Let's look at what the Quran says regarding this. Allah says, أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا كَمْ أَهْلَكْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ مِنْ قَرْنٍ مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَا لَمْ نُمَكِّنْ لَكُمْ. Allah says, مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. We made them grounded on this earth. Yeah, and we gave them tamkeen, solidified them on the earth. Allah is attributing it to who? Himself. In another ayah, Allah says, وَنُمَكِّنَ لَهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَنُرِيَ فِرْعَوْنَ وَهَامَانَ وَجُنُودَهُمَا مِنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَحْذَرُونَ. Allah says, we made them grounded on this earth. We solidified them. Allah says in another ayah, وَلَقَدْ مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي مَا إِن مَكَّنَّا فِيهِ. In another ayah, Allah says, إِنَّا مَكَّنَّا لَهُ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَآتَيْنَاهُ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ سَبَبًا. By the way, إِنَّا مَكَّنَّا لَهُ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَآتَيْنَاهُ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ سَبَبًا. It's talking about Dhul Qarnayn. Allah made Dhul Qarnayn solidified and the powerfulest person for the people at that time. At the ending, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala mentioned why. He says, مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ سَبَبًا. Sababan here means knowledge. He was actually in charge of all of them. And was
there's,
the one.
There's no denying that Allah is the one who brings this honor, but just because He is a musabbib, it doesn't mean we abandon the asbab.
So He told us how to do it.
Yeah, from the asbab is to influence the leaders and the rulers.
Allah mentions now that He's attributed to Himself, that He's the one who gives us tamkeen on this earth. Allah is going to give us power on this earth. Allah is going to give us honor on this earth. He attributed to Himself. So we know it's in whose hands? Allah. Mm-hmm. Allah set the way for us. The first one I just mentioned is that Dhul Qarnayn. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He clearly said, إِنَّا مَكَّنَّا لَهُ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Dhul Qarnayn, we made him grounded on this earth. Allah is saying, we did it. وَآتَيْنَاهُ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ سَبَبًا. But what we gave this man is knowledge. Ibn Abbas, Qatada, Dhahak, Ibn Jurayj, and Ibn Jarir even chose this opinion, is that the word sababan here means ilm. Who are the people who are running the da'wah, who are running activism for the Muslims in America, in the UK and everything? They're the jahala, the ignorant ones. They have no knowledge of the religion, to be honest with you. They have nothing to offer the Muslims in terms of knowledge. They're not ulama. And I'll speak about what conditions can make a person a scholar.
You know, I haven't finished. Okay, no problem. Go ahead.
The conditions that make this also, the things that the people have to understand to attain tamkeen, Allah mentions it. Allah says, الَّذِينَ إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. The people who are going to give tamkeen to this earth are who? أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ, they establish the prayer. وَآتَوُوا الزَّكَاةَ, they give the zakat. وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, they command one another good. وَنَهَوْا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, and they call against each other the evil. وَلِلَّهِ عَاقِبَةُ الْأُمُورِ, and the final ending is for Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala and His believers. Pay attention here. أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ, the Muslims in the UK, majority of them will pray Musalah. I'll leave the answer to you. وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ, the all the Muslims in the UK are wealthy like that. And also in the West, they all pay their zakat. I'll leave the answer to you. وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهُوا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. When the Muslims are told, this is munkar, stay away from it. You know what they say. And وَنَهُوا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. And when they're commanded to do the good, what's the response they give and the excuses they give? That's conditions Allah mentioned. These are the ones that we give them to. Allah says in another ayah, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Allah made a promise. And Allah's wa'ad is true. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا those who believe in amongst you, minkum, وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ and who, they come with iman, they come with righteous actions. لَا يَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ Allah will make them powerful on this earth. Allah will give them the upper hand on this earth. كَمَا اسْتَخْلَفَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ like he's given to ones before. وَلَيُمَكِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمُ الَّذِي ارْتَضَى لَهُمْ And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will solidify their religion for them. This is, and Allah will be pleased with their religion for them and the way that they are. وَلَيُبَدِّلَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا The fear that they had, Allah will change it to prosperity and safety. The fear they had, Allah will remove that from them. Shahid, look at this. يَعْبُدُونَنِي لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا They worship me alone and they don't associate partners with me.
I often think that in the hot seat, it's a battle between practicalities and real life versus theory.
Shahid,
no, I'll tell you why. Because in France right now, they are banning Muslim sisters from wearing the hijab. You can have your teaching your books in the masajid. You can have your cultivating the youth. You can have your teaching them knowledge. And your mother, your sister, your wife is walking outside without hijab because of a government legislation. That's what it comes back to.
Shahid, at the beginning, what did I say to you? Anyone who opposes that which Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and his messenger sanctioned, when the hadith I mentioned, that the people, when they oppose the command of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will place on them humility that he will not remove from them unless they go back to their religion. I'm saying to you,
they want to go back to religion. They want to wear the hijab, but
I'm not denying there is a nice, practicing, righteous community in all countries in the world. In the West, there are righteous people, better than I, okay? More noble than I am, more righteous than I am. That's not a denying. Mm-hmm. But what I'm saying to you is when the dim-witted ones, the ignorant ones are more in number, the disobedient ones are more in number. Like we have figureheads, let's be very frank and honest, okay? Mm-hmm. We have people who are saying, the poet said, وَمَتَى يَبْلُغُ الْبُنْيَانُ تَمَامَهُ إِذَا كُنْتَ تَبْنِيهِ وَغَيْرُكَ يَهْدِمُ When would we reach success? If you're trying to build a building and then somebody's taking the bricks out from the bottom, when is that building going to reach its fullness, full, complete version? It won't. We have people who are saying, democracy is Islam and Islam is democracy. And we have people who are saying, let's agree to disagree on everything and let's work together and hold hands. We have people who fight against the fundamental things of Islam. Fundamental things of Islam. And then they come with this, I call it this false desire to say that we need to change the Muslims, that we need to do something for them. But when is it going to happen? If you want to take a path to bring the ummah success, تَرْجُ النَّجَاةَ وَلَمْ تَسْلُكْ مَسَارِكَ إِنَّ سَفِينَةَ لَا تَجْرِي عَلَى الْيَبَسِ You're looking for success, you're not taking its path. Wallahi, you're not going to reach success. قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي وَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ The ayah mentions, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ This is my path, the Prophet said. The Prophet has a path. قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ I use this path, the Prophet said, to call to Allah. عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ I call the people through this path. I do that and those who follow me. وَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ We are saying here, the calamities that have hit us, وَمَا أَصَابَكُم مِّن مُصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَيَعْفُ عَنْ كَثِيرٍ The calamities that have befallen us, the type of leaders that we have upon us, the kind of world that we're living in today, there's no one else we need to blame except the one who's talking, you who's listening, and every Muslim should point him the finger at himself. Fir'aun, who we know what he is. Fir'aun, who claimed and said, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى Fir'aun, with all of that, Allah told us in the Quran, Fir'aun was only placed upon the people because of their own actions. Allah said, فَاسْتَخَفَّ قَوْمَهُ فَأَطَاعُوهُ إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا قَوْمًا فَاسِقِينَ They were transgressive people. They were criminals. The people were criminals. And Allah made Fir'aun a leader for them. When the people become disobedient to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and they go against Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's commands, Allah will place upon them devils in the forms of humans. Allah will place upon them wolves that have no rahmah, mustard seed of mercy. وَكَذَلِكَ نُوَلِّي بَعْضَ الظَّالِمِينَ بَعْضًا بِمَا كَانُوا يَفْسُقُوا بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, like that we place transgressive people above them, Allah places a tyrant individual who has no rahmah for them. Masur ibn Abi al-Aswad, he mentioned when he came to the ayah, وَكَذَلِكَ نُوَلِّي بَعْضَ الظَّالِمِينَ بَعْضًا بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ Durratul al-Manthur, Suyuti mentions it, that Sulaiman ibn Mihran al-A'mash, the great imam, he was asked about the ayah, وَكَذَلِكَ نُوَلِّي بَعْضَ الظَّالِمِينَ بَعْضًا That some oppressive people, they're going to have an oppressive leader above them. Hey, this ayah. What's the meaning of this ayah? And you know what he said? He said, إِذَا فَسَدَ النَّاسُ, if the people are corrupt, أُمِّرَ عَلَيْهِمْ شِرَارُهُمْ, the evilest of people will take over them. That's the type of people. وَلِذَلِكَ, the scholars, they used to say, عُمَّالُكُمْ أَعْمَالُكُمْ, your leaders is a representation. It's your action that has been put into form of a human. You're talking to your action.
Yeah. No, Paul, we're talking about like what came first, chicken or egg. My whole argument is that I agree that people are corrupt. The people on the ground are corrupt. But the easiest way to change them is to change the laws and the legislations that are making it hard for them to practice their religion. You'd rather take the approach of changing millions and millions of Muslims rather than changing one or two at the top, one or two non-Muslims at the top.
Where does the leader come from? The earth?
The leader comes
from the sky?
Okay, you're saying that the leader will come from the people that you correct on the ground. Ah. In a non-Muslim society, the leader does not come from the Muslims.
Who the pause? You said the Muslims have to lobby and go to the government, right?
Correct.
And you want them to represent us.
Yeah, correct.
Muslims are gonna, so you want some people to represent us. I really try to avoid mentioning names, but let me just mention names now. We have a woman in the States, America. Mm. She's from the Somali community. She's from a very famous area in America where a large number of Somali community live. Yani the largest Somalian community in the West is in that place, Minnesota. The people elected her. Mm. Her name is Ilhan Omar. Ilhan Omar is holding hands with the LGBT community. Who's she representing?
The
people who chose her. No, it's not a street. Give me figureheads. Give me the mithal I can do tatbiq of it.
I'm not going to mention names either, but there are people who represent organizations who are genuinely working with the governments.
No, Shahid, but Shahid.
Ulama.
No. Let's stop now. We come to who are ulama. This woman, Ilhan Omar, is now, whether she's holding on to Islam or whether she is a non-Muslim, that has to be a niqash, a discussion. I'm not saying she is and I'm not saying she's not. But a discussion can be open on that issue. Okay, Shahid, pay attention. This is very serious. Okay, why? What is the reason why we have this problem? So who's going to lobby when we choose the person? Who's going to represent us as Muslims? You can't give me a response to that. Shahid, in Islam, look at from the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam until Sheikh Abdul Aziz Mubaz, carry on, all the ulama, even till now, look at it. The people who took the people out of azamat, calamities and problems were not individuals who are nothing. Ulama took the people out. The Prophet was the first one, alayhi salatu wasalam, and then there were ulama after that. Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Sahabat wa Rasulillah. Ulama, qarnam
ba'da qarnin. So why can't the ulama, according to you, according to your definition, why can't they be more active?
The ulama are taking the approach sanctioned and set by Allah and His Messenger.
How long is your approach going to take?
It's long. It's very long.
Of course it's long, because you're trying to correct millions of Muslims. And
like the Prophet
did. And it's been an ongoing approach for many, many centuries and decades. And guess where it's got us to this point?
The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw the Sahaba suffering in Mecca. Khabab radiallahu ta'ala anhu was suffering. He said to the Prophet, Allah tad'u lana, are you not going to make dua for us? Allah tansuruna, are you not going to give us victory? The Prophet alayhi wa sallam, he said to them, kana fi man kana qablakum, there were those who came before you. Rajulun يُحْفَرُ لَهُ الْأَرْضِ, a man will be taken, the earth will be dug for him, he will be placed in the earth. وَيُوضَعُ الْمِنْشَارُ عَلَى رَأْسِهِ, the blade will be taken and will be placed on his head. وَيُجْعَلُ النِّسْفَيْنِ, he will be made into two. لَا يَسُودُ ذَلِكَ عَنْ دِينِهِ شَيْئًا, his religion will not move, this man solid, till he dies he will be like that. The Prophet then صلى الله عليه وسلم, he swore by Allah. Muhammad ibn Abdullah swore by Allah. We would believe him without him swearing by Allah. Imagine if Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم swore by Allah. He said, "Wa lidhi ma nafsi bi yadihi, I swear by the Lord, my soul in his hand. Wallahi la yasiru raqibu min san'a, a rider will ride from san'a ila hadra maut. He fears nothing except a wolf to eat his patch of cows or camels or sheep." Then the Prophet said to the companions that were there, "Walakinnakum tastajilun, that they will come, but you guys are hastening. Khabbab, Ammar ibn Yasir, Bilal, you guys are hastening. This is sunnah of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala that will forever be." Sheikh Albani already said this. طريقتنا طويلة ومديدة. Yes, our path is long. But it's the only path. That's the path when the Prophet sat down with his companions and he said, وَأَنَّ هَذَا سِرَاطِي مُسْتَقِيمًا فَاتَّبِعُوهُ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلَ فَتَفَرَّقَ بِكُمْ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِ ذَلِكُمْ وَصَّاكُمْ بِهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. When the Prophet took the twig and he made a line on the earth, I mean, he could have just recited the ayah. These are Arabs, they can understand what he's saying. And khalas, he could have done that, right? Look what he did. He said, he took up twig. A picture draws more than 1,000 words. He drew a line on the earth for them to make them really internalize what he's going to say to them. And he said to them, وَأَنَّ هَذَا سِرَاطِي مُسْتَقِيمًا فَاتَّبِعُوا. That's my path, follow it. وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلَ. Don't make these paths, don't follow them. What's going to happen when you follow these paths, Shahid? فَتَفَرَّقَ بِكُمْ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِ. It will take you away from the real path, the path that's to Allah. There's only one road to Allah, by the way. There isn't roads, only one road. The ayah said, وَأَنَّ هَذَا سِرَاطِي مُسْتَقِيمًا. But when he talked about the other parts, what did he say? وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلَ. He made it plural. The path to Allah is only one. Yes, our path, inshallah ta'ala, is that one. We hope Allah to keep us upon that path. That path which involves being, holding on to the Quran and the Sunnah with our scholars, our ulama. Shahid, definitely there's a point I need to mention here, which is these people who are activists now, who are running around trying to say that we need to remove the problems from the ummah, who are taking it upon themselves. They are taking it upon themselves, Shahid, to respond to the doubts that the orientalists and the non, that are trying to put themselves out there to defend the religion. And they're not ulama. And they are harm to the community and a problem to the community. Ulama are who? Ulama are the people who've inherited Risalatul Muhammadiyah, the message of Nabiullah Muhammad. Look when the Prophet said, he said, Innal ulama. Before I go into this, there's a narration that Nafi' ibn al-Harith mentioned that Umar radiallahu anhu met his amil in Usfan. Usfan is a place just outside Mecca. Umar radiallahu anhu met his amil in Usfan. Should I pay attention to this? When he met him, Umar said to him, hey, if you're here, the amil is Nafi' ibn al-Harith. He met Umar outside Mecca. So if he was meant to be in charge of Mecca, Umar then said to him, "Manista'amalta ala ahli al-wadi? Who's running the affairs of the people of Mecca? Who have you left with the people of Mecca? If you're here, now meeting me here." He said, "I placed Ibn Abza. Ibn Abza is the man in charge." Umar said, "Waman Ibn Abza? This Ibn Abza, who's he?" He said, "Mawla mi mawalina. He's a slave that was freed from our slaves." Umar said, "Istakhlafta alayhi mawlan? You've placed a man who went through slavery over people who've never gone through slavery." In other words, what he meant is normally the people who've gone through slavery generally are not learned and studied, and people don't even know how to run things. And you have to understand, Shahid, this is Mecca. This is where it all started from. Imagine. Then the man said, إِنَّهُ قَارِئُ لِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ وَإِنَّهُ عَالِمٌ بِالْفَرَائِضِ. He didn't say he's an activist, he knows فِقْهُ الْوَاقِعِ. He didn't say all of that. He said this man has memorized the Quran, قَارِئُ لِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ, and knows the meaning. To show you that he knows the meaning, he said, وَإِنَّهُ عَالِمٌ بِالْفَرَائِضِ. Inheritance is the hardest chapter. He said he knows inheritance. And this man knows the tafsir of the Quran. Umar radiallahu anhu didn't say, nah, we need a man who's acquainted with the land. And he didn't say that. He said, أَمَّا إِنَّ نَبِيَّكُمْ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ قَدْ قَالَ. The Prophet said to us, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَرْفَعُ بِهَذَا الْكِتَابِ أَقْوَامًا وَيَضَعُ بِهِ آخَرِينَ. Allah will place a person high just because he's got the Quran. Ibn Abza is a man who went through slavery. His people he's governing are people who are what? Who are Quraysh, the Prophet's people. That's the people he's governing. Shahid, I ask you a question. Hadith al-Imam Muslim narrated in his Sahih, min hadith Umar ibn al-Khattab. What was he governing them with? The Quran and the Sunnah. That's what this man had. The Prophet ﷺ placed the people of the Quran above everybody else. Times of fear, who are we commanded to go back to? Allah says, وَإِذَا جَاءَهُمْ أَمْرٌ مِنَ الْأَمْنِ أَوِ الْخَوْفِ أَذَاعُوا بِهِ وَلَوْ رَدُّوهُ إِلَى الرَّسُولِ وَإِلَى أُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْهُمْ لَعَلِمَهُ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَنْبِطُونَهُ مِنْهُمْ وَلَوْ لَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَتُهُ لَاتَّبَعْتُمُ الشَّيْطَانَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he said, if they were to bring the matters back to the people who are referred to as Ulul Amri, who is Ulul Amri? Al-Imam Al-Qurtubi, what did he say? Ulul Amri ahu huwahum ahlul ilmi wal fiqhi. Times of fear and security and issues of safety and security. Don't bring it to the students of knowledge.
So who are the ulama in the West then?
Now, I'm not going to give you names.
Because there aren't any?
I'm not going to give you names. Because I don't know. I don't want to speak and say these are, because I might be right or wrong.
That's not a problem though. That's
Let's apply these principles, and whoever it applies on, if the shoe fits, if the shoe fits.
What if it doesn't fit anybody in the West?
Then there isn't.
Okay, well then isn't that a problem? Because now you're outsourcing fatawa to the people who don't even know our condition.
If the people, Shahid, don't have knowledge, doesn't give them the right to say, we haven't got scholars, so we should have to give fatwa. Because we know the waqi' and we know the reality. If you know the waqi' better than the scholars, as you say, and I have to be honest, I'll be fair. We do know the waqi' in the West better than the scholars. No, I mean, there's no denying. I don't think any sane person would deny that. Mm-hmm. We do know the waqi' better than, I know UK better than Sheikh Salah Al-Fawzan. The haqq, la miryata fi. That doesn't give me the rights to give fatwa in the religion. I've only got one portion, which is the waqi' I understand. He has the ilm. I have not got knowledge. I'm skin. I have no knowledge.
You have people who have some knowledge of the religion and the full reality of the West.
They're not Ahlul Ijtihad. These are issues of security and safety. These people are taking positions like who should we work with the LGBT community or not. I mean, wait. You're not Ahlul Lidalik. You're not fit for this role. This is not you. Call the ulama, present the situation to them. By the way, when I say ulama, a lot of people are just going to think, oh, he's referring to the Saudi scholars. Of course, they're part of the scholars I'm referring to. But they're not only the scholars. There are scholars around the world. You go back to them and you bring it to them. And they are Ahlul Ijtihad. They'll look into the issue, revise the issue, and give it to you. Shahid. First of all, let me describe who a scholar is and who isn't. Because these terms are loosely being used. People who are not even considered students of knowledge, I wouldn't even consider to be students of knowledge, are called ulama, this alim. He's a scholar, kaif. How's he a scholar? And this is a problem because when we play with terms like that, it becomes a problem. You see, we're just beginner students of knowledge. We're just beginner students of knowledge.
So what makes a scholar then?
The first condition of a scholar is that indahu, to him is Risalatul Muhammadiyah. He has the message Nabi Muhammad came with. He knows the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. ولذلك the Prophet, look what he said. He said in hadith Abi Ahmad narrated in his Muslim, in hadith Abi Darda, إِنَّ الْعُلَمَاءَ وَرَثَةُ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ. The ulama inherit the prophets. وَإِنَّ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ لَمْ يُوَرِّثُوا دِينَارًا وَلَا دِرْهَمًا. They did not inherit from them money, by the way. What they inherited from them, what? وَرَّثُوا الْعِلْمَ. فَمَنْ أَخَذَهُ أَخَذَ بِحَذٍ وَافِرٍ. The first knowledge they inherit from the Prophet is what? The Quran and the Sunnah. That's what the Prophet gave them. وَذْكُرْنَ مَا يُتْلَى فِي بُيُوتِكُمْ مِنْ آيَاتِ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. The Quran and the Hikmah. Hikmah means the Sunnah. Those are the first two they inherit. Anyone who doesn't know anything about the Hadiths, anyone who doesn't know the Quran, he's not an alim, however much he screams on the pulpit and he screams and he screams. But I tell you this, he's not an alim, the one who knows Arabic grammar. He's not an alim. The one who knows usul al-fiqh is not an alim. The one who knows balagha is not an alim. The one who, no, that doesn't make them an alim. A alim is a person, first condition, is that he has the Quran and the sunnah. That's the ulumul ghayat. He has the maqasid, the objectives, the Quran and the sunnah. All of these are stepping stone to these two. Pay attention to that. The second thing that he has is ma'rifatu wujuhul qira'at. This man knows the different qira'at of the Quran. And Imam Ahmad narrated in his Musnad from Abu Darda. Abu Darda, he said, لا إنك لا تفقه كل الفقه حتى ترى للقرآن وجوها. You're not a faqih. They're taking out fiqh issues, stances that we need to take. Qa'am, khas, mutlaq, muqayyad. They're taking rulings. Abu Darda is saying, إنك لا تفقه كل الفقه. You are not going to be a faqih, as the word faqih is. حتى ترى للقرآن وجوها. Until you see different qira'at in the Quran, different recitations. This qira'at is explaining this one. ولذلك أيوب Ibn Abi Tamimah al-Sakhtiyani explained what Abu Darda meant. He said, يَهَابُ الْإِقْدَامُ عَلَيْهِ. The person, when he learns qira'at and everything, he starts to realize, I need to hold back. The third thing he needs, a person who's alim, is what? مَعْرِفَةُ أَقْوَالِ الصَّحَابَةِ. He knows the statements of the Sahabas. Sa'id ibn Abi Aruba, what did he say? مَنْ لَمْ يَسْمَعِ الْإِخْتِلَافَ فَلَا تَعُدُّهُ عَالِمًا. Do not consider him a scholar. The one who does not know the difference of opinions amongst the Sahabas. And he doesn't know the different views that Ibn Abbas said this, Ibn Abbas said this, Ibn Umar said this, Ibn Mas'ud said this, Abu Huraira said this. If you don't know the different views amongst the Sahabas, فَلَا تَعُدُّهُ عَالِمًا. Don't consider this person alim. Malik ibn Anis, he said, لَا تَجُوزُ الْفُتْيَا. Fatwa is not permissible for إِلَّا لِمَنْ عَلِمَ مَخْتَلَفَ النَّاسُ فِيهِ. Until he knows what the people differ upon. Yani the people here, the Sahabas. And then they asked him, أَقِيلَ لَهُ إِخْتِلَافُ أَهْلِ الرَّأِيِ. Are you talking about the differences of the people of Ahlul Ra'i? He said, لا. اختلاف أصحاب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then he said, وعلم الناسخ والمنسوخ من القرآن ومن حديث رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He knows the abrogated verses and that which are not abrogated. تاجدين السبكي, he said, إن المرأة إذا لم يعرف علم الخلاف والمأخذ لا يكون فقيها إلى أن يلج الجمل في سم الخياط. تاجدين السبكي, look what he said. He said, if a person does not know the khilaf and the reason for this khilaf, he doesn't know it. لا يكون فقيها. By the way, the word فقيه and عالم are synonyms. مجتهد, عالم, فقيه are synonyms. He will not be a scholar. Look what he said. إلى أن يلج الجمل في سم الخياط. Until a camel goes through the needle. عبد الملك ابن حبيب, he said, I heard Ibn Majashun. Ibn Majashun is a student of Imam Malik. I heard him say, كانوا يقولون, the scholars, يعني Malik and other great scholars used to say, لا يكون إماما في الفقه. A person is not going to be a person of fiqh, understanding of fiqh, great scholar of fiqh. ما لم يكن إماما في القرآن والآثار. If he doesn't know the Quran and the آثار. Abdullah ibn Mubarak was asked, متى يسع الرجل, when is it, متى يسع الرجل, when is it allowed for a man, and يفتي, to give fatwa from himself. He said, إذا كان عالما بالأثر بصيرا بالرأي, unless he's a عالم in the أثر, the text, Quran and Sunnah. And the رأي here means a fiqh. He knows how to extract the benefits from it. The fourth thing is, لا يتتبع أقوال الشاذة. The person does not follow strange views. Wallahi, many of them are bringing أقوال الشاذة, filling it up with the ummah. And people are referring to them as scholars. Weakening the hadiths based on their own hawa and desires, the way they like it. Ibn Mahdiyun. Ibn Mahdi is the sheikh of Imam Shafi'i rahimahullahu ta'ala. He said, لا يكون إماما في العلم. A person is not a scholar. من أخذ بالشاذ من العلم. Anyone who takes the strange and leaves off the what the ulama have stated in their works. A scholar is a person, when we look at his works, which is the fifth one, is he's what he got right and what he got wrong. What he got right is more. We don't believe our scholars are infallible, by the way. We know that they can get it right or wrong. لكن حافظ بن عبد البر, حافظ المغرب, he said, لا يسلم العالم من الخطأ. A scholar is not without mistakes. فمن أخطأ قليلا, if he does his little mistakes, وأصاب كثيرا, he gets many right, فهو العالم, he's a scholar. ومن أصاب قليلا, anyone who gets it right some little time here and there, he gets it right. وأخطأ كثيرا, فهو الجاهل. Also, the person who is an عالم is the one who can defend the deen. He has the strength. We're hearing them saying, I got doubts. I had these doubts for so many years. You're not an alim if doubts are going to creep into you. An alim has the strength and the ability to defend the religion. The Prophet told us, عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, يحمل هذا العلم من كل خلف عدوله ينفون عنه تحريف الغالين وانتحال المبطلين وتأويل الجاهلين. They're going to come a scholars, Ahlul Ilm. They're reliable people. They will prevent from the religion تحريف الغالين, the extreme interpretation of those who try to do it. وانتحال المبطلين, and they will also prevent the religion from any additional thing that's been added to it. وتأويل الجاهلين, and the interpretation of those ignorant ones. In other words, this statement, Khatib al-Baghdadi mentions in his Kitab Sharaf Ashab al-Hadith, Ibn Abd al-Barr mentions it in his Tamheed, I read it from. Pay attention, Shahid. This is combining between two things. He can defend the religion with al-riwayati wa-diraya, the narrations, what he's got in his head. I was taken back when I came across a statement of Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Ahmad was asked, can a person give fatwa if he's memorized 100,000 hadith? Of course, the Quran is finished. He's memorized 100,000 hadith. Can he give fatwa? He said, la. He said, 200,000. He said, la. This is 300,000 hadith he's memorized. By the way, hadith memorization from Ahmad ibn Hanbal is with the chain, of course. There's a time of chain. Mm-hmm. 300,000 hadiths, he's memorized it. Can he give fatwa? He said no. They said 400,000. He said maybe. And then people come today and scream and say, "Akhi, the shurut al-mujtahid that the scholars mentioned is so stiff and it's too hard. Subhanallah, these conditions. Where is it from the Quran?" Yani, the person can defend the religion. ولذلك عبد الكريم بن عوجان, when he came out and he got the leader of the Muslims grabbed him and he said, okay, he was going to be executed, and he said, execute me if you want, I'm dying and I've left like 4,000 ahadiths that I made halal which was haram and haram that which is halal. The leader said to him, you know, he said to him, you're going to die for sure, it's not going to change anything. لكن he said يعيش لها الجهابدة. Great scholars are going to live for this. عبد الرحمن بن مهدي took it. He said give it to me. عبد الله مبارك took it. What's it called? أبو نعيم فضل بن دكين. يعني these people sat down and they threw all the dirt and the filth he added into it. يعيش لها الجهابدة. Our ones today, what are they doing? The doubt comes. It's a valid point. It's a valid point. In Islam, I'm going to last conclude this one.
Okay.
In Islam, the great scholars who brought our religion to us, not only did they do that, they were the best people to have protected for the Muslims their prosperity, their glory, were the ulama. The poet, he said, إِذَا قِيلَ مَنْ فِي الْعِلْمِ سَبْعَةُ أَبْحُرٍ رِوَايَتُهُمْ لَيْسَتْ عَنِ الْعِلْمِ خَارِجَةً فَقُلْهُمْ عُبَيْدُ اللَّهِ عُرْوَةٌ قَاسِمٌ سَعِيدٌ أَبُو بَكْرٍ سُلَيْمَانُ خَارِجَةً Seven, فُقَهَاء السبعة. The seven jurists in Medina that sat. These were the, إِذَا قِيلَ if it said, مَنْ فِي الْعِلْمِ سَبْعَةُ أَبْحُرٍ oceans in knowledge, رِوَايَتُهُمْ لَيْسَتْ عَنِ الْعِلْمِ خَارِجَةً Their narrations, their understanding, their content. فَقُلْهُمْ عُبَيْدُ اللَّهِ عُرْوَةٌ قَاسِمٌ سَعِيدٌ أَبُو بَكْرٍ سُلَيْمَانُ خَارِجَةً Seven men. Which then trickled into the four imams that we have, Abu Hanifa, Malik, Shafi'i and Ahmed, and the madaris that came out from all of that. The point I'm trying to say to you is, we don't want activism from Jahala. We don't need ignorant people running our affairs. We don't want it. The people we need for them to run our affairs and help us and get us out of these problems have to be scholars. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, they use an example. Ibn Taymiyyah, you're not, لا تساوي قلامة ظفره. You're not equal to his nail and what he was like. And the knowledge and the understanding that Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah had. ولذلك الإمام ابن حجر رحمه الله تعالى he praised a book called الرد الوافر by Nasiruddin al-Dimashqi. This kitab is praising Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Hajar took that book, read it, and then he put a taqreed on it. Taqreed meaning he put a appraisal on that book. And he spoke about Ibn Taymiyyah. He spoke about Ibn Taymiyyah and he said about Ibn Taymiyyah and how great he was. He said, and this is a seventh reason for a person to be a scholar, which is his students. Ibn Hajar said, praising Ibn Taymiyyah, he said, وَلَوْ لَمْ يَكُلْ لِلشَّيْخِ تَقِيُّ الدِّينِ If Ibn Taymiyyah didn't have anything else, مِنَ الْمَنَاقِمِ no other virtue, إِلَّا تِلْمِيدُهُ الشَّهِيرُ شَيْخُ شَمْسُ الدِّينِ ابْنُ الْقَيِّمِ He only had Ibn Qayyim as his student. الجوزيه صاحب التصانيف النافعة السائرة التي تفع بها الموافق والمخالف The people that benefit from Ibn Qayyim's works. If Ibn Taymiyyah didn't have no other يعني virtue to be praised for, except that he produced Ibn Qayyim, he said, لكان غاية في الدلالة على عظيم منزلتي. That's enough to say Ibn Taymiyyah is a scholar.
And if Ibn Taymiyyah was living in the UK right now, would he be confined to the masjid teaching books, going to his house, staying with his family, go back to the masjid
Ibn
teaching
books, produce,
or would he be actively involved in trying to quit the society? What do you honestly think?
Ibn Taymiyyah was producing scholars and Ahlul Ilm. No doubt I'm saying
Wasn't
to
he
you,
doing both?
This is my point. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah's path is what we're saying. Rahimahullah ta'ala. Ibn Taymiyyah produced Ibn al-Qayyim. He produced Ibn Abdul Hadi. He produced Ibn Kathir. He produced Imam al-Dhahabi. He produced and benefited from him was Abu al-Hajjaj al-Mizzi, for Ibn Munasif, Ibn Samit, Ibn Muhibb al-Samit, Alamuddin al-Barzali. يعني, these people are from the madrasa of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah who sat in front of him and he benefits from.
Yeah, but why can't you do both? Why can't you teach and produce students? I'm with you. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. Mm. But why can't you also get, like they say Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah did, why can't you also get politically active? Why can't you do both?
I said the approach in which we need to take in order to bring the problems from the ummah is the way I said for you. We need to go back to ourselves.
Which is different from Ibn Taymiyyah.
This is what Ibn Taymiyyah did. Ibn Taymiyyah was tasfiyah wa tarbiyah. He educated the people. Remember when the Tatar came to the Muslims and was harming the Muslims, Ibn Taymiyyah said, we're not ready for it. Let's study, let's learn. By the way, Ibn Taymiyyah ran away from Harran, his place of birth. And he ran to Damascus with his father. And his father collected all of the books that he can. And they ran away. Ibn Taymiyyah took time to educate the people. يُعَلِّمُهُمْ وَيُرَبِّيهِمْ Nurturing them, educating them, benefiting the people. And then he reached where he reached. And got the people to that position.
He wasn't actively involved in society. That's what you're saying.
I'm saying he was.
He was, right?
Ibn Taymiyyah was serving the peoples, yani from their knowledge, from everything. He was doing all of that. He was giving tarbiyah to the people. He was helping the people. He was, yani when I did this research, I was reading from the works of Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah and his books as well.
Was he helping the rulers? Was he advising the rulers? Was he helping?
I'm saying now the rulers, there's three things that people need to do for the rulers, the Muslim rulers.
I was talking about Muslim rulers.
The Muslim rulers, three things we need to do for them. Dua, that Allah guides them to that which is good. If they're harming the people, may Allah, you know, subhanahu wa ta'ala, guide them to the best and bring them back to guidance. And if they, that's one, a dua. Third one is al-nusr, advising them. We go to them and we advise them. If you know they're doing something wrong, go knock on their door, advise them. Whether there are other people sitting there or not, it doesn't matter. If he's there, he's right in front of you, talk to him. And the third one is as-sabr, to be patient upon his situation. Khalas, why do I have to go to the leader? Why do I have to knock on his door every time? Why do I have to be around him? And these people, and by the way, this whole movement is not just restricted to the UK. It's actually happening in the world. And in the Arab world, it was happening in the Arab world. A man by the name of Abdurrahman Abdul Khaliq, who recently died, may Allah forgive him, was pushed that concept. And he's actually one of the people who pushed it in the Arab world. So it's not, these arguments are not just for the West, by the way. It's actually present in the Muslim world as well. And he was the one who pushed it and argued for it. And Sheikh Albani refuted him. It's musajjal. There's a discussion between Sheikh Salah Ali Sheikh and Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala. This approach, Sheikh Al-Albani condemned it, spoke against it. Sheikh Nasir rahimahullah kept saying, Tasfiyah wa tarbiyah. Who is now more beneficial for the ummah? Did you even hear about Abdurrahman Abdul Khaliq? Did you even know he died? Like in Sheikh Nasir, are we benefiting from his works? Hadahu. That's what it is. People will remember Ahlul Ilm, Ahlul Khair. I was yesterday, last night, I was reading the book of Qurrat Aynul Muhtaj, which is a sharh of Muqaddimatu Sahih Muslim ibn Hajjaj, written by Sheikh Muhammad Ali Adim al-Ethiopi, benefiting. He's left something for me to, yani, me and my son, I got the iPad, I was making my son read it. And he's reading it, and I'm watching it. If he corrects or gets it wrong, I correct him. Well, we're benefiting. Sheikh left something for me and my family to benefit from. You see, he's played a role in rectifying our situation and the problem that we're in. Lakin, to get yourself into this issue of activism, when you're not fit for it, you will destroy more than you will benefit.
So what you're saying, and correct me if I go wrong, but I want to summarize what you've said today so far. You're saying that the best way for the Muslims in the West who can't leave the country, they have to remain there. The best way for them to get out of their situation is to correct themselves from the ground up, educate themselves, teach themselves knowledge, and in the process, Allah, and get closer to Allah, of course, and in the process, Allah will change their condition for them and make things easy for them. And you admit it's not an overnight process, it's a long process, but you say it's the only process that has to be taken because it's the prophetic way, number one. And number two, you can't do both. You can't do this on the ground and you can't influence the government, because if you do, you will compromise on your religion. Right. And you brought examples of people who have done that. And the third thing that you touched upon now is that the scholars, the ulama, who should be in charge of these kind of decisions, none of them are politically are involved in political activism. And the reason for that is because they recognize that this isn't the right way. And therefore, the ignorant ones have actually stepped forward and got involved in political activism, and in the process, compromised on their religion.
I mean, look at what the Prophet ﷺ said to us. The Prophet said, وَمَنْ أَتَى أَبْوَابَ السَّلَاطِينِ افْتَتَى. Anyone who comes to the doors of the leaders, trials and tribulation will hit them. The Prophet said this, وَمَا زَادَ عَبْدٌ مِنَ السُّلْطَانِ قُرْبًا إِلَّا زَادَ مِنَ اللَّهِ بُعْدًا. There's not a person who gets close to the leader and starts working with the leaders and is all up in the leader's life, except that he will become distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Imam Ahmad and Bayhaqi narrated bisanadin sahih.
So what if someone says to you, this is a secular methodology because you've separated religion from the state?
No, I didn't.
You what have, I because said you said concentrate on your religion and leave the politics.
No, I didn't say leave the politics. In the sense, the way you're trying to put it, I'm saying to you, the politics today, as Albani rahimahullah said, he said, وَمِنَ السِّيَاسَةِ تَرْكُ السِّيَاسَةِ. Politics meaning? Today is to leave politics. Because of this politics al-wad'iyya that the people have set, is not something you want to get your shirt tainted. Wallahi, what is politics today is not what somebody wants to be part of. I'm saying to you, if you want to bring honor for the Muslims, honor and power and strength and the upper position, we can be done. Not in the way you're going about it. I'm not saying Islam's not about leadership and control over countries and systems. Of course we are. We have those chapters in fiqh. I'm not denying that. I'm saying the approach for that is not the way you guys are. And just because I said that approach is not right, doesn't mean I'm against the idea of leadership and how the governments are run and the systems are run. I'm not saying that. I'm saying to you today, the way that I believe a leader should be advised if he's a Muslim leader is a dua. Make dua for him. The second one is an-nusuh. Advise him. Advise him. Say, Sheikh, you know, what are you doing? This is wrong. Change this, rectify when I'm with him. Third one is sabr. I'm patient with whatever comes from him.
Can you do the same for a non-Muslim ruler?
The non-Muslim ruler, my situation with him and the way I am is I don't care what he does. I need to protect my community.
You can't make dua for him. Allah guide him to Islam.
My situation with a non-Muslim is...
Can you do that? Is it permissible?
No.
It's not permissible?
Which one? For Allah to guide him.
To make dua.
Of course, everyone
can make dua. Okay, that's permissible. If you're with him, you happen to be with him, it's not permissible to advise him in a Muslim community, we're a big community in your country, maybe make one thing we're struggling with is X, Y, Z.
I don't want to be put in a position where I want to apply the same thing for a Muslim, non-Muslim. What I'm saying to you is that the non-Muslim, we have a different dealing with him.
Okay? Which is,
there is in Islam contracts that we need to have with him and we need to abide by that contract, that system that we've set with him. For example, if you come into his country, there's a system, it's a contract. If those contracts are not in place, there's a jihad that goes between us and them. Yeah, and there's a niqash, it's a bath that I don't want to go into right now. I'm saying, if we're living in this country now, we choose to be from those people, we're stubborn, we don't want to leave, and we don't want to do hijrah, okay? I'm saying we're stubborn, and we don't want to take those fatwas, and we ignore it, and we choose to stay in the West, then do this. Your community are suffering. Wallahi, going lobbying and being MPs won't help you. Ilhan Omar is not helping the Somali community. I'll promise you that. I know it. It's my people. She's not. She's a problem to them. She's an embarrassment to us right now. Wallahi, we're so embarrassed that she's representing the Somalis, wallahi, and the things that she's saying. I mean, I don't know any Somali sane person who still looks up to her. Total embarrassment. And many more like that are going to come. And the matters are going to become worse. Okay? And we have the same in the UK. The mayor of London, was his name?
Sadiq Khan
is not of any value for us. And these du'at, when some of them, we questioned them, we said, lobbied. Hey, this guy is in power. Hey, what has he done for the community? What benefit does he bring? Wallahi, one of them said to me, I don't want to say his name. He said to me, just the fact that name is a mayor of London is enough for us.
Isn't that a good thing? It's better than not having a Muslim name.
La ilaha illallah. His name just...
Yeah, is that not a good thing?
If a non-Muslim...
It makes Islam more tolerant along amongst non-Muslims. They get used to saying his name. They get used to seeing him on TV.
Wallahi, it doesn't deserve an answer. Wallahi, it's sad. Wallahi. That his name is enough for us. Mm. Even to the extent we became so humiliated that we found out Boris Johnson, his mom's Turkish or his dad Turkish or something like that. And we said, look, he's got ilaha illallah. That's the reality for the Muslims today.
Okay, I want to give you a scenario. You're getting a flight from you live in the UAE right now. You're going back to the UK, visit your family, whatever. You're on the flight. You happen to be sitting next to Boris Johnson. You're not going to talk to him about Islam and maybe tell him.
Yeah, I would.
You are?
Yeah.
So that's what these people are doing. They're just speaking to the people.
About Islam?
Not just about Islam, but even about some of his laws and regulations that are making it difficult for the Muslims.
I don't believe that.
Okay, you hear.
Because I've been in circles.
Okay,
where
okay, one second. You hear Boris Johnson is going to implement a law that's going to ban all the massage in the UK. You don't mention it to him. You don't say Boris is going to be a problem for us.
No.
You would?
No, I'll send a letter to him.
Yeah, why can't you? You're right next to him.
I'll talk to him. Yeah, of course.
Yeah, you would.
So I mean, he's next to him. I'll talk to him. If he's not, even if I'm at home in London, I'll send a letter to him. And
okay, that's what people are doing.
Okay,
that is political activism. What you just described.
No, Shahid, this is okay. Mashallah. Okay, now I think we're on a different page. What's happening here is that these people are saying, leave the massages. The durus is not working. This method of yours, Abdurrahman, is not working. Please stop. Get engaged in politics. Read the update of what's happening in politics. Keep up with what's happening, the laws that are being passed. I'm saying that's not going to benefit in any way, shape or form.
There is a party who say that, but if there was a middle ground and a party who said, we believe in your approach, carry on, and I'm going to do my approach, so we're tackling it from both angles, would you be upset at them?
And I'm going to do the tadris and the ta'alim of the people.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, if he succeeds in it, it's up to him.
Yeah, there's no issue with someone doing that.
Doing what?
Being politically active, trying to influence rules. If he agrees that you can do your thing.
Sheikh Nasir Al-Din Al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala, a great imam, he said something. He said, even if we told everybody to leave it, there's always going to be people who are not going to listen to our advice, he said, who are going to still be in it. We'll still ban it. We say, Muslims, politics is going to calm you. I'll tell you something. Politics does two things to a person who goes into it. He loses his religion. Hatmullah miryata fi. It's a reality. There's no debate about that. He'll go and come back to the community who trusted him, who believed in him and said, go, represent us. He comes back and he brings them gharaib, strange things. Second thing that he does is to him, is it, so the religion goes. And the second one is that it destroys that person's aim and objective, he himself, the goal that he was trying to achieve. So it harms him as a person. He starts to shave. He starts to look different. He starts to, people start, he even says, no khutbat al-haja. There's people actually who went to big figures. They sat in front of Obama, George W. Bush, and you know, they changed Allah to God. And it's not, I'm not blaming them per se. I'll be very honest with you. Because I know Siyasi the way it works. His script was checked before he even read it. He wrote it. He cannot just read it out like that. Yani, he goes there. He has to say, God said. He can't say Allah said. He says, Amen, instead of saying, Ameen. He has to say, yani, the ayah, he can't read it in Arabic. Everybody's going to be like, what did he just read? Shahid, to be honest with you, the democracy does not serve Muslims. Because democracy is built upon the majority. And Islam, majority are upon falsehood. وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ وَإِنْ تُطِعْ أَكْثَرَ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ يُضِلُّكَ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ Allah تبارك وتعالى said, وَقَلِيلٌ مِنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ The majority are misguided. The majority don't know. Little remember Allah and obey Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my point is, why are you running in an area where people are going to question you after that? And a lot of these people, not for 1 minute do I believe. I'll be honest with you. Because at-tariq yu'idu nafsa, history repeats itself. No way do I believe that these people are doing it for their communities. These people, you mark my word and remember it one day. These people are running for power and positions. They're not serving the community.
That's an issue that's inside their heart. I don't think we can say that.
I know history. I see in tariq, historically, I read works in the Islamic world. I read all of that. These people are running and lobbying and going for themselves. And once they get into power, they don't represent their communities or these people. Whatever can keep them in power and whatever can keep them in strength. Ibn Badis, rahimahullah, warned against Jam'iyat al-Ulama of Jazair. They banned this concept. Al-Bashir Ibrahimi, Ibn Badis, the scholars of Ansar al-Sunnah, Abdul Wakil, and Muhammad Hamid al-Fiqhi and Sheikh al-Albani in Syria, يعني Ahmed Shakir, and يعني all of these scholars, أخي, they were not representatives and mayors and MPs and whatnot. They stuck to them, and this is what the Ummah are reaping today, the benefits of their works.
Okay, I have a couple of closing questions before I want to move on to the issue of protesting. The first question I have is that if we adopt your approach and we don't get involved politically, we're never going to get a Muslim person in power. And if we don't get a Muslim in power, there's going to be laws and regulations that are going to be continued to be passed that are going to make it extremely difficult for the Muslims in the West to practice their religion.
Shahid, I think at this point, we kind of stressed on it before, and to make it even more clearer for the people, is that the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the righteous people, who aided them, who supported them. Let's take, for example, Nabilah Hud. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said about him, إِنِّي أُشْهِدُ اللَّهِ وَشْهَدُ أَنِّي بَرِئٌ مِّمَّا تُشْرِكُونَ من دوني فكيدوني جميعا ثم لا تنظرون إني توكلت على الله ربي وربكم ما من دابة إلا هو آخذ بناصيتها إن ربي على صراط مستقيم نبي الله هود what did he say to the people? He said, go and plan and plot, all of you guys, come together and plan. Do not wait, do not delay, do not hold back. Just plan everything against me. إني توكلت على الله, I relied on Allah تبارك وتعالى. ربي وربكم, my Lord and your Lord. Rabbi wa Rabbikum, my Lord and your Lord. مَا مِن دَابَّةٍ إِلَّا هُوَ آخِذٌ بِنَصِيَتِهَا There's nothing on this earth except Allah is holding it. Allah has got control over it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Nabi Allah Hud, that's what he said to him. Also Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he mentioned, وَتُلْ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ نُوحٍ Nabi Allah Nuh, إِذْ قَالَ لِقَوْمِهِ يَا قَوْمِ إِنْ كَانَ كَبُرَ عَلَيْكُمْ مَقَامِي وَتَذْكِيرِي بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ فَعَلَى اللَّهِ تَوَكَّلْتُ فَأَجْمِعُوا أَمْرَكُمْ وَشُرَكَاءَكُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْرُكُمْ عَلَيْكُمْ غُمَّةً ثُمَّ قُضُوا إِلَيَّ وَلَا تُنْظِرُونَ Nabi Allah Nuh said to his people, if me calling you to Islam, me calling you to Allah has become something very hard for you guys to digest and to accept, then he said, now go and plan against me. فَعَلَى اللَّهِ تَوَكَّلْتُ I rely on Allah تبارك وتعالى فَأَجْمِعُوا أَمْرَكُمْ Bring your matters together, unite against me, come together, call your allies, your coalition, come against me. ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْرُكُمْ عَلَيْكُمْ غُمَّةً ثُمَّ قُضُوا إِلَيَّ وَلَا تُنْظِرُونَ Come against me, destroy me, do what you want to me. Don't delay, he said. But I have Allah. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said about him, قُلْ ادْعُوا شُرَكَاءَكُمْ ثُمَّ كِيدُونِ فَلَا تُنْظِرُونَ إِنَّ وَلِيَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِي نَزَّلَ الْكِتَابَ هُوَ يَتَوَلَّى الصَّالِحِينَ Do the same. Come together. Unite. Support one another. Aid one another against me to destroy me. But remember one thing, inna waliya Allah, Allah is my ally, Allah is my side, Allah is the one that's going to aid me, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is the one who wa nasiru da'wa, this religion, Allah is going to give victory to it. Wa mu'ayyiduha wa hafidhuha. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is the one that's going to take care of it. Allah is the one that's going to serve it, and Allah is going to protect it. To think you're the one that's needed, if you're not found, this religion is going to crumble and everything's going to be destroyed. And it's tawadha, humble yourself. This religion is going to be defended. And you were told to take this path like the prophets took. They gave da'wah, they preached, they called to their Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you do that, leave the rest to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And I'll tell you something we've taken from the West, which is we think the means and the result are in our hands. No, it's not. The results are in Allah's hands, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We just have to come with the means. We just have to bring our part to the table, or come with our part, and the rest we rely on Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala loves this religion and his deen better than we do.
So from the means, and you admit that obviously it is upon us to take the means, even if we're not in control of the end result, what is the solution then?
Shahid, we have to there are a couple of points I want to mention, inshallah ta'ala. The first one is the first solution for the Muslims, if they want to get everything right, is that ar-ruju' ila da'wah, going back to the da'wah. And the way that we go to back to the da'wah is ila masariha as-sahih, in the correct way, which is al-ilmu wa ta'lim, learning, acquiring that knowledge and teaching it, purifying the people from three things: purifying the people from shirk, purifying the people from bid'ah, and purifying the people from ma'asi and sins. If a government bans alcohol and the people still choose to drink it, you know, we know drugs are illegal in the UK. Let's just take that ala sabili tamthil. And drugs are being sold in a large quantity in the UK. People are making millions from it. Some people are rich millionaires from drugs. So what government can impose is not really necessarily what's going to always work. The people could stop all of the drugs if they get nurtured correctly. So at-ta'alimu wa al-ilmu wa-ta'alim, learning and attaining that knowledge and then teaching and benefiting the people is the way forward.
So just to stick on that point, because I think that's really important, and just to repeat it for the viewers, you're saying that if we do our job with correcting the people on the ground and teaching them the religion of Islam the way it should be, it doesn't matter what law the government pass, because it will never affect the people, because they will know that this is wrong. That's what you're saying.
Correct.
Okay, valid point.
The next point that I think, inshallah ta'ala, is leave the du'at and the students of knowledge in the fields that they are in. Don't drag them into politics. Don't drag the students of knowledge and the du'at from a very strong part that they are holding for the community and bring them into politics. The reason is because the masjids become empty. And when the masjids become empty and the circles of knowledge goes, you're going to have a corrupt community. And looking at it today, we see that. The du'at have been told, come out. If he gives a kitab on fiqh and tahara and salah, and he's belittled. He don't even know the waqa of the Muslims. When we have Muslims who can't even do ruku' properly and sujood and can't pray, we belittle that. The Prophet ﷺ sent individuals, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, and he said, Ya Mu'adh, innaka sastati qawma min ahli al-kitab, faliyakun awwala ma tud'u minay shahadu an la ilaha illallah. Fainuma ta'awuka lidhalika fa'akhbiruhum anna Allah fatarad alayhim khamsa salawati fi kulli yawmin wa layla. Mu'adh, listen, you're going to go to the people of scripture. Let the first thing that you call them to be, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. When they obey that from you, move on to the second. And that is what? Salah. Once they accept that from you and they do that, move on to the third, which is zakat. He didn't say go there, lobby, get the Muslims together, get them be active. He didn't say that. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He called a da'i, leave him in his field to preach to the people and call them. When the Prophet said, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, another companion, he said, Yassira wa la tu'assira, bashira wa la tunaffira. Make matters easy on the people, don't make it hard. Yani, give glad tidings, don't be a person who causes havoc. Yani, he gave them approaches of da'wah and how to call. The next point is, these matters that we think that the Muslims are suffering from, it has to happen. The solution should be looked for, and it should be taken back to the people of knowledge. And yaquma, al-ulama, the scholars, and the talabatul ilm should be connected. The students of knowledge should have scholars over them, where they go back to, they refer back to, they keep bringing matters back to the ulama and getting it from them, ahlul ijtihad. It's not... It's not an insult to you if someone says you're not a scholar, because you're not. And it's fine. You're not having reached that. And it's an honor for you to be even a student of knowledge, even if it's a beginner student of knowledge. It's an honor. It's not an embarrassment. And make your steps forward. Inshallah ta'ala, if you be sincere and you're genuine and you carry on and you carry on, inshallah ta'ala, Allah will make you a mujtahid one day, inshallah ta'ala, if you carry on. But don't hasten what you don't have. مَنْ اسْتَعَجَلَ شَيْءٌ قَبْلَ أَوَانِهِ عُوقِبَ بِحِرْمَانِهِ. If you work, you claim that for yourself, you're not going to ever reach it, and you're always going to think you're a mujtahid and you never attain knowledge. So the majority of the people who are now forefront are not ulama, myself included. We're not scholars. The scholars are those people who I mentioned those conditions for. Those people are the ones that we should give the matter to, and they should run it. There's never been a struggle in Islamic history where the Muslims made it through, except that it was done by the ulama. Okay, it was the scholars that did it. And a good relationship between the scholars and the students, but not students, or even those who are not students. For example, Ilhan Umar, where did she learn? What deen is she? I don't even think she's ever studied the deen. And so those are the type of people who are going to run the affairs of the entire Muslim community. لذلك, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِذَا وُسِّدَ الْأَمْرُ إِلَى غَيْرِ أَهْلِهِ فَانْتَذِرِ السَّاعَةِ. If matters are placed in the wrong people's hands, then wait for the hour to strike. And that's exactly what we're seeing. Also, my advice would be دراسة, studying the history that took place. Go back and study and learn what the Muslims have gone through the last 100 years. By the way, this Islam, the Khilafah, went down. This is when all of this started. Okay? But study, take time out and study. Some of it I mentioned already, the Jamaluddin al-Afghani and Muhammad Abdu and Muhammad Rashid Rida taken from him, and wahakada, and then it creeping into the Muslims like that. And then Abdulrahman Abdul Khaliq having been the first so-called Saudi student of knowledge who studied, pushing this into the Salafiyun. Because he studied in Saudi Arabia, studied with the prominent Salafi scholars like Albani rahimahullah ta'ala and whatnot. He then came to the West, went back to Kuwait, and he pushed this ideology in Kuwait after he opened Jami'ul Turath. He's originally Egyptian, but they gave him jinsiya Kuwaitiya, and he formalized this approach for them. But before this was not known for the Salafis, and the Salafis didn't have this issue. It was Ikhwani and the children they gave birth to, which is Hizb al-Tahrir. And the Salafis were not like that. Salafis were tasfiyat wa tarbiyah by Sheikh Albani, Sheikh Ibn Baz, Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, and they were nurtured by these great imams. Okay? So study the history that took place. And study history, read these works that have been written, the discussion that the ulama have had, the events that have taken place. Did these people make it through? What happened to them? What happened to Muhammad Rashid Rida? But study it. Look at what happened. Look at Jamaluddin Afghani, what he did, Muhammad Abdul and what he said and how his life was and how historic. Look at the ulama of Jazair and the position they took, the ulama of Ansar al-Sunnah and the position they took. Read their fatwas, look at their mawaqif that they took. I'm saying, if we're all looking for glory and success for the Muslims, and that's what we're trying to attain, inshallah ta'ala, the way that I've mentioned is what the Dalil supports, the Quran and the Sunnah supports that method. And the people who argued for this are the people till today whose names are mentioned. We mention them, we speak about them. Have you ever heard?
We mention them in our circles, but there are also political activists who are mentioned in the
Sheikh Albani affects governments. His fatawa shook governments and systems. Wallahi. His books, his works. Don't you think to yourself that from the masjid and from the pulpit and from the khutab that you do, it can't affect systems and government. It does.
Okay. It's a long path, but as you said, it's the prophetic path. And spiritually, if someone wants to focus on the spiritual aspect, the reason is that the Dalil show, if you take this path, Allah will be the one who grants you victory. And if for anybody who, it shouldn't be the case, but if there's anybody who isn't content with that spiritual aspect, then even logically, if you cultivate and teach the people, then it doesn't matter what rules are coming from above, they're going to be able to recognize right from wrong. I think that's a strong argument. One thing that I just want to clarify, even for my own sake, clarifying through this discussion with you, is It seemed like your stance at the start of the conversation was talking more about it has to be this way and nothing else. And then when I brought up the analogy of you sitting next to Boris Johnson, you said you'd advise him, write him a letter. Does that mean that it's not, does that mean that you can do an element of both? You, as long as you have this thing where you are teaching and cultivating the people, as long as you have that as a cornerstone and the main aspect of your da'wah, can you do a little bit where it's involved with lobbying and political activism? I want to clarify just for my own sake in this conversation.
You see, engaging in the politics today, I said that's something a Muslim shouldn't do. You should not get yourself, because this politics is a system that's
correct. That's what you would have done if you wrote Boris Johnson a letter. That's my point.
No, so two things. Being part of the system and becoming an elected member and then going to the system and everything, I don't think anyone should hope anything from you once you go into the system, because the system carves you. It sets your priorities. It sets your goals. It your dressing and the way you talk and the way you talk, all of it, you adopt it from that environment, that surrounding that you're in. In no way any da'i would I advise to do that. And I think that goes against Nusus al-Wahyain. But if any Muslim sees that a Muslim is being oppressed and he has the ability to stop the oppression by writing a letter, by speaking to the local MP, by even entering upon the local MP and saying, what are you doing is wrong. These people are, you know, they chose you, they this, they that, and he advises him and he leaves. There's not, this is, whether they call that activism or they name it, whatever they call it, that's right.
Okay.
And nusuh and advice and correcting problems, that's not what we're arguing against.
Okay. But it's always from outside the system, and it's also with the teaching going on in the masajid.
I'm even myself, my own self, rectifying my own actions, my ibadah, the Muslim needs to just understand this system, it's going to change you. You're not going to change it, to be honest. That's the truth. That's what you're going to learn after many years of your life. What you can change, though, no one can stop you from it, is the community and society. People's hearts and their love for the religion. No one can, that's what you have. Imagine these people haven't got anyone from the ground. That's when the ulama became powerful. Because they had more of the followers than the people than the leaders did. And the leaders were forced to go to the ulama and say, please, can you tell the people, please. That's what has it. Al-Izz ibn Abdissalam, if you look at what historically happened, and you will be amazed. Why? Because Al-Izz ibn Abdissalam and alcohol, they said it was open. Al-Izz ibn Abdissalam. And he got angry and he said, I'm not going to stay in a place where alcohol is open. And look where he reached. And the people of the village all packed up and said, we're going with you. If you go, we're going with you.
Okay.
The leader had to say, I didn't know, where is it? And shut it down. Yani, he didn't have power in the seats and he just was mukhlis. Allah says in the Quran, وَإِن تَصْبِرُوا وَتَتَّقُوا لَا يَضُرُّكُمْ كَيْدُهُمْ شَيْئًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِمَا يَعْمَلُونَ مُحِيطٌ. If you show patience and taqwa, forbearance, tolerance, resilience in your religion, and you're patient, the three types of patience, at-ta'ah, patience upon ta'ah, patience upon obedience of Allah, patience upon from sins, patience upon the calamities that befall you, and then you show taqwa, piety, which is four things, al-khawfu min al-jaleel, fear of Allah, wal-amalu bil-tanzeel, acting upon the Quran and the Sunnah, wal-ridha bil-qaleel, being pleased with the bare minimum Allah has given you, the little Allah has given you, being pleased with it, wa-sti'adadu liyawm al-raheel, and preparing for the day of judgment. If you come with that, Allah says, la yadurrukum, it will not harm you. Kayduhum, their plans and their plottings that they are planning against you. Inna Allah bima ya'maluna muhit. Allah is the one that encompasses them all. That's, I don't find anywhere in the Quran where Allah Ta'ala says, lobby, do this, that. And I've not seen that. Okay. The Quranic hadiths I read, it's the case. And Shahid, look at it yourself. Even the ones who have gone to that power position, there are individuals we know who've reached a chance, an opportunity was given, a window of opportunity was given to them. And it's online, you can check them up. They're sitting now in front of the, yani, as they say, the most powerfulest man on the face of this earth. They call POTUS, the President of the United States, right in front of him. And guess what? His whole entire lecture is censored. What he said, what he, and he could say, you wouldn't, if you closed your eyes, you wouldn't even think this letter came from a Muslim. Bismillah, he can't say khutbatu innal hamdalillah, he can't say it. Yani, he can't say Allah. He can't say, yani, that's the reality.
Okay.
So is that we're going to spend all of our life to get to there? And then once we reach that position, our whole entire lecture is censored. We can't say what we wanted. We struggled. We've put, Don't go to a place where you're humiliated and you're belittled and you're mocked and you're. The truth of the matter is, our honor is going to come once we all obey Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Our honor will come through when we take the prophetic method.
Mm-hmm. So you mentioned that there are some means we can take that are outside of the system that we as Muslims can take. From that, a lot of people ask the question, is protesting from the means, is protesting in a non-Muslim country, is it from the means that are permissible for us to undertake to try and impact some kind of change?
Okay, before we place a ruling on the issue of mudaharat, protesting, the scholars, they say, al-hukmu ala shay' far'un an tasawuri. To place a ruling on something, you have to first of all have a correct perception of it. So there are terms which are slightly similar to mudaharat in the Arabic language or in English demonstration, which is what is called sit-in or strikes.
Okay, what's that?
So sit-in, for example, in the Arabic language, they call it i'tisamat. It basically means a group of people come together, they sit somewhere, and they said, we're not going to move until this is done.
Mm.
And strikes, we see a lot in the UK, especially London, bus strikes happen, or hunger strikes or whatever. All of these are what we're talking about.
Okay.
So we mean that by the concept of demonstration and that protest, and we mean all of that. The mudaharat are types. So if we don't mention the types of mudaharat, then we can't give one blank ruling for all of them.
Okay, that makes sense.
And that's why I feel like many people who spoke about it, whether it be in the Arabic language or whether it be in English language, or even many people who've written books on it, whether it be shuyukh and mashayikh who've written it, a lot of them, personally, in my personal opinion, they didn't deal with the issue in a very scholastic, scholarly method, a lot of them. And the reason for that being, they didn't mention the aqsam al-mudaharat, the types of mudaharat there is, and then each one given it its suitable ruling. They gave a complete ruling for different types, and then it's always a type that doesn't really fall under that reasoning. So the types of mudaharat are the following. The first one is mudaharat, which is with the intention and the aim of changing the system.
Mm-hmm, okay.
And that happens in three forms. The first one, which is trying to change the system or trying to upthrow the system. And it happens in three different ways. It's either in a Muslim country where that Muslim country doesn't allow protesting. The second one is it's trying to change a system where it's under a Muslim power, under Muslims, a Muslim leader, lakin it doesn't prevent people from doing mudaharat.
The Muslim leader allows protesting?
He allows it.
Okay.
And the third one is under a non-Muslim country.
Okay.
So it's not a Muslim country. The second type is mudaharat, protesting that is done with the aim and the objective of changing a situation from the situations that are there. You're not trying to put the system down, you're not trying to drop the government or anything, or upthrow the government. The aim here is just taghyiru hal. You just want a situation to be changed from the situations out there, or you want to take a position in something. The third form, which is the last, is that the aim for this protest is just to bring to the government, to their attention, a particular issue like global warming or something like that. Yani bring this situation to the world. Those are the three forms. So the scholars, they gave a ruling on mudaharat. They said it's not allowed, it's not permissible. They got it from the Quran and the Sunnah, but they had to explain their reason for why it's haram. And there's 5 points which they took. The first point is that it's بِأَنَّهَا بِدْعَةٌ مُحْدَثَةٌ. They said it's a newly invented matter. The second reason is because بِأَنَّهَا مِنَ التَّشَبُّهُ بِالْكُفَّارِ. It's imitating the non-Muslims. The third reason they gave is that they said this is مِنْ وَسَائِلِ الْإِنْكَارِ, a means of rejecting something. And the means of rejecting something has to be taken from the Quran and the Sunnah. The fourth one is بِأَنَّهَا مِنَ الْخُرُوجِ عَلَى وَلِي الْأَمْرِ. It's going against the Muslim leader. And the fifth reason, the mudaharat that they said is not allowed, is because لَا تَخْلُو مِنْ مُخَالَفَةِ. There is in it things that are in opposition to the Quran and the Sunnah. وَأَنَّهَا يَتَرَتَّبُ عَلَيْهَا مَفَاسِدٍ. And there are harm and problems that come from the mudaharat. Now, let me go through each reasoning that the scholars gave. Not all of them are valid. The first one, which is, it's a newly invented matter. To say that something is newly invented It means, yani to say something is newly invented in and it's an innovation, it means that this person is attributing this to the religion. Mm-hmm. So there are a group of people who basically do believe that mudaharat is a ibadah, an act of worship. These people, yes, this applies on them. It's an innovation. Where's your evidence for it? And they won't be able to bring any evidence for it. Because it's a newly invented matter, it's an innovation. And we then read a hadith, مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلَ لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَوَرَدْ. But there's a party of people who say, no, for us, it's not an act of worship. It's actually an adah, a norms. And a norms, we can't refer to it as a bid'ah, because it's outside the realm of ibadah. Mm-hmm. It can only be considered an act of ibadah or a mu'amala to be considered it to be innovation. The person has to have done it for what? يقصد به التقرب والتعبد لله. So what we understand is that
just translate that in English?
That the person is trying to get closer to Allah by this action, or they are trying to worship Allah through it.
Okay.
So if a norms or a custom and a mu'amala is done to get closer to Allah by it, and you're doing it to worship Allah, then it becomes an innovation if it's not legislated. Mm-hmm. So a man says, I'm not going to marry a woman, and I'm going to get closer to Allah by that. The Prophet said that's bid'ah. Mm-hmm. But he could leave the woman if he wants to. He doesn't have to marry if he doesn't want to. But to say, I'm going to get closer to Allah by not getting married to any woman, it's an innovation. Even though originally it's what? It's a mu'amala, or it's an adah, or it's a mu'amala, which the person could just do if they wanted to. But now that they've chosen to get closer to Allah, it becomes an innovation.
Okay.
So a group of people will say, I am doing the mudaharat, and my aim and objective is not to get closer to Allah by it. I'm not worshipping Allah with this action. And it's just a means for me. So we'll come to that one. The second reason that some scholars bring forward by saying that it's imitating the non-Muslims, again, is also very weak argument. The reason is because what is a dhabit for tashabbuh? And we kind of mentioned that before. What's the dhabit for tashabbuh? Yani what is tashabbuh of the kufar? Tashabbuh bil kufar, Shaykh al-Islam Taymi has a kitab, one of the strongest books that's written in this field of tashabbuh. There are many books written on it, but one of the greatest books is the kitab Iqtida' al-Sirat al-Mustaqim Mukhalifat Ashab al-Jahim by Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah clearly and categorically, and Al-Shatibi and other great scholars mention that the real, the concrete point for tashabbuh is that this is an action. لا يفعله إلا الكفار. Only the non-Muslims do this. يعني it's khas for the kufar, uniquely known for them. And if it's something that the people all do out of norms, this is not a tashabbuh, even if the non-Muslims do it. It has to be something uniquely known for them. And rather, we see this concept of mudaharat actually present at the early times of Islam. For example, Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, when the people went against Uthman and they uprose against Uthman radiallahu anhu, and they took him down in Khalifatul Rashid, Uthman ibn Affan, that was demonstration. And then it turned into violence. Also, we have the issue of Abdurrahman ibn al-Ash'ad when he went against Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi. That was mudaharat. And it was happening at that time. So it's saying it's a thing done by the non-Muslims. I mean, it's very far-fetched. And also, this concept of rejecting oppression and pushing away oppression, and it's something which human beings are generally used to doing that. Whatever means they take is different. But people don't like to be oppressed and they don't like to be wronged. So again, the concept of it being a tashabbuh bil kufar is also not a strong argument.
Mm-hmm.
Now we are left with a point which is that it's going against an oppressive Muslim leader. And that's, again, not applying to the land of the non-Muslims.
Correct.
Because if it's oppressive, the Muslim leader is one of two situations. He's either a righteous, noble, just leader. He's a just leader. Mm-hmm. Of course, people wouldn't generally want to go uprise against that one, except dim-witted, ignorant people. The second one is that he's an oppressive leader. And this, we have clear-cut evidences that state that we can't go against the oppressive Muslim leader, which the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentioned, alayhi salatu wasalam, patience, endurance. And the three things that we do for that Muslim oppressive leader is to make dua for Allah to guide him. That's clear evidences for that. We go and we give him nasiha, we advise him. And the third one is as-sabr, patience on what he's doing to the Muslims. But that doesn't apply to non-Muslim countries. So we now come to the non-Muslim country.
Okay.
The fourth one is that it's a means of rejecting. So wasa'il al-inkar. Their argument is, Habibi, Akhi, I'm rejecting falsehood. Now, you might ask yourself, isn't that, if you're rejecting falsehood, is that not innovation again? Or the first one that we mentioned, what's the difference between the two? The difference between it is wasila means can lead to good and it can also lead to bad.
Okay.
Whereas bid'ah only leads to bad because it's not something. Also, the wasila, the means a person can take, there are specific evidences that come for it. Whereas the bid'ah, of course, is without evidences. Also, means can enter into ibadat, mu'amalat, adat, act of worship, people's interactions, and it can also enter people's norms and customs. Bid'ah only enters act of worship. So they say it's wasila for me then, which is the fourth reason. It's a wasila. So now what we have to do is we have to divide the wasila means into two.
Mm-hmm.
There's a wasila known as a wasila mahda. It's pure means. And we have to do this in order to understand the whole discussion and the whole dialogue.
Okay.
The wasila mahla, it's pure wasila. Yani it's pure wasila. The wasila which is mahla is, the person intends this action. I mean, he intends this means in order to reach something. But this means cannot be detached from the means.
Mm-hmm.
That is a pure means. It's a means that's connected to the objective. Like walking to the masjid, for example. If someone walks, he doesn't get rewarded for it by itself.
Right, okay.
But the minute he walks to the masjid, the reward is connected to it's connected to. He walks to a brothel, the punishment is on him. So the walking, it's a pure means, meaning it's purely connected to the aim and objective. There's another one which is called wasa'il nisbiya, means which by itself can stand. Like wudu, for example. Wudu, whether you're doing it for salah or not, just by doing wudu itself is a reward.
Okay. Yeah.
By itself, it's a means that can stand by itself.
Okay.
That's important that we understand it. Another point that I want us to understand is that there is a qa'idah for us, which is called al-wasa'il la'hkam al-maqasid. The means takes the ruling of these objectives. So if the objective is wajib, the means becomes wajib. Right, as long as that means is not prohibited.
Mm-hmm.
Pay attention to that.
Mm.
If, for example, going to the masjid for the men is wajib, right? So you know the only way you can go to the masjid is by driving. Driving becomes obligatory.
I see.
The means takes the ruling of the objective. As long as that means is not haram. If you take a means which is haram, then it's not permissible. The means has to be permitted, allowed.
Okay.
There's a qa'idah shaytaniya that some people use, which is al-ghayatu tubarriru al-wasila, which is nothing to do with Islam. It's a qa'idah shaytaniya, which means the goal justifies the means.
Hmm.
The goal justifies the means. And when you look at the mudaharat today that we see, that's the qa'idah that is built upon. The goals justify the means. So the means here can be corrupt. So this qa'idah shaytani, which is al-ghayatu tubarriru al-wasila, has nothing to do with Islam. That the goal justifies the means. And that if a person wants to, example, do something which is evil, or something good, if he takes an evil means for it, it's no problem. Example is, for example, I steal 10 dirhams from you, but I give 9 in sadaqah and I just take 1.
Okay.
So, yani, how many sins do I get? 1, right? But I've given 9 sadaqah. The person thinks like that. This is al-ghayatu la tubarri al-wasila. Just because you're trying to achieve a goal doesn't mean the means justifies it.
Okay.
And this is what demonstration falls under. Now, I need to speak about something very important, which is means in da'wah tawqifiyya or is it ijtihadiyya? And I think it's very important. And this is why what I'm trying to get to. Yani, in order to reject falsehood, which is a means of da'wah, is it tawqifiyya? Or is it ijtihadiyah? What does it mean? Does it have to be taken from the Quran and the Sunnah? Or can it be independent reasoning? There are also three terms that people generally try to use with the concept of wasila means. They use the word wasa'id, and the issue of dhara'i, and the issue of maslaha. Before I answer that question, I have to explain those three.
Okay.
Dhara'i, for example, is microphones. They say, for example, if you say that the means has to be sanctioned by the Sharia, Allah Azza wa Jalla, They say microphones. And they say, for example, radios and, you know, mobile phones and things that we use for khair. Mm-hmm. You see?
For da'wah.
For da'wah. We say that's not wasila. That's wasa'it. It just projects what's there. It doesn't interfere with the message itself.
Okay.
Okay. And there's also something called dhara'i', which is a term that's also used similar to wasa'il. Dhara'i' are things that will always lead to evil. Okay. And there's a third term, which is maslahatul mursala. Whether maslahatul mursala exists or not, I'm not going to be speaking about that there. Yeah. I've already explained my position on masalih mursala. That the masalih are three types: masalih mu'tabara, masalih mulghat, and masalih mursala. In the Sharia, there's only maslahah mu'tabara and maslahatul mulghat. Amma maslahah mursala, we don't believe that. And anyone who claims there is maslahah mursala, anyone who claims it, will say either this maslahah was mu'tabara, the Sharia already stated it and you didn't know about it, or it's mulghat, the Sharia dismissed it.
What's the best translation for it in English?
It's benefits that came about after.
Okay.
So even if we do say that maslahah mursala exists, just so we get the discussion flowing, maslahah mursala means it's a means that will lead to good. That's why it's called maslahah mursala. So it's a means that will lead to good. When we look at the means that is taken for protesting, it doesn't lead to good. It leads to evil. It's actually closer to being dhara'i' than maslahah mursala. It's a what? It's a dhari'ah. Meaning, dhari'ah is like, for example, a man touching a woman, which will lead to what? Zina.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Mudaharat leads to evil, which is going to bring us to this point, which is the last and final point, which is the harms that are in protesting. Protesting, first of all, goes against the da'wah of the prophets, which work towards what we mentioned before, islahur ra'iyyah, changing the people, yani from the bottom upwards. Protesting is from the top to the bottom, which we will get fighting against. It goes against the da'wah of the prophets and the prophets. The prophets started with the people. They go to the leaders first. Second thing that it has is protest is idafu aslul wala'i wal bara. It corrupts the concept of al wala' wal bara. The third one is people lose their lives and blood sheds, and a lot of the protests that happen. Four, people lose their honors and people rob and steal yani people's belongings and people lose. Black Lives Matter, for example. Muslim people suffered more from it because it started in Minneapolis. People who own shops were losing their products and everything. اختلال الأمن, it destroys safety. It also disrupts the people's yani day to day. Yani roads get blocked off, people can't go to work, people are stressed, what route am I going to take? Also, it opens the door for the criminals. فَتْحُ الْمَجَالِ لِلْمُفْسِدِينَ مِنَ الْمُجْرِمِينَ وَالْمُخَرِّبِينَ. Corrupt people are there. اخْتِلَاطُ الرِّجَالِ بِالنِّسَاءِ. Men and women are going to freemix. It's also الصَّدُّ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَعَنِ الصَّلَاةِ. It prevents the people from remembering Allah تبارك وتعالى and the salah. And the people miss the salah from this. Also, this is opportunity. I know brothers who said, yeah, I met a girl there. I'll go there because I want to get her number. تَضِيعُ الْأَوْقَاتِ وَالْأَمْوَالِ فِيمَا لَا خَيْرَ فِيهِ. People waste their time and their money in things that don't have no benefit sometimes. Also, the way to go about things is either nasiha, knock on the door, advise a person, or make dua for Allah to guide him or whatever, or be patient. Another problem that we see it is raf'u sha'arat al-jahiliyah. People are pulling up yani symbols that are not Islamic. Yani sometimes concept yani that are shirkiyat and kufriyat when you look at the billboards. Also, finally, it's a way of actually affirming the concept of democracy and secular liberal states. Democracy can't exist if there's no demonstration. The whole concept of democracy is what? The people, the power is in the hands of the people. It's giving the people, the word democracy, it means the people, the power is in the hands of the people. The people choose. So it goes against fun, and Allah is the one who chooses what can be or can't be. Finally, mudaharat is about what do the majority think. That's when the government starts looking. If a minority is screaming, they don't care.
Mm-hmm.
And the majority are always going to choose what is corrupt and not which is good. So the fifth reason is what the real strongest point is, Shahid, which is the final one. لا تخلو من مخالفات. And the first four are not strong.
Okay. especially in a non-Muslim country.
The strongest reason for mudaharat is, I'm talking about non-Muslim country. For Muslim country, the issue of
khuruj is khuruj,
that's there. Okay. But the non-Muslim country I'm talking about, the non-Muslim country, the strongest way to speak against democracy, protest and demonstration is to say, بِأَنَّا لَا تَخْلُو مِن مُخَالَفَاتِ وَأَنَّا يَتَرَتَّبُ عَلَيْهَا مَفَاسِدِ.
And I want to go into this. You've mentioned a lot of information and I want to break it down. I want to go into it. So at first you mentioned that there are actually three types of protests. There is one to overthrow the government and that breaks down into three. There's one in the Muslim country with a Muslim leader who doesn't allow protest. And then there's one in the Muslim leader of the Muslim country who does allow protests, and then you've got the non-Muslim country with the non-Muslim leader. The second type of protest is when you're not trying to overthrow a ruler, but you're trying to change one of his laws, for example. And then the third type is you're not trying to change anything, but you're just trying to raise awareness of a particular issue. I want to go back and really apply some of these five reasons why protests are haram and see where they fit into this. The first one, you have a Muslim country with a Muslim leader who is not allowing you to protest. Obviously, the reason why this is not permissible is because of khuruj. Agreed?
It's a Muslim country and it's not allowing you to do it.
Yeah. What if it's a Muslim leader in a Muslim country and he is allowing protests? Does this still take the rule of khuruj or not?
Yeah, it does.
It does.
It goes under khuruj, even if the Muslim leader allows it. The reason is because Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen pointed this out. It's very important. He says that the Muslim leader generally does it because of pressure from outside. The non-Muslim country is saying, you're not a democratical state. You don't govern by democracy. So to please them, he says to the people, you can uprise. But he's really finding it as a problem.
Okay.
And so the Muslims, they were already commanded way before anybody. You know, when we say we don't go against the leader, we're not doing it because of him. We're doing it because Allah's messenger told us this. So yes, it's not allowed for us to go.
Okay. Now we come to the non-Muslim countries. And this is where we can talk about three different things. Overthrowing a non-Muslim ruler.
Approver.
Using a protest to overthrow a non-Muslim government in a non-Muslim country. Out of the five that you mentioned, the reasons for protesting not being permissible, which one applies here?
The last one, which is بِأَنَّا لَا يَخْلُو مِن مُخَالَفَاتِ.
Okay, this applies to all three. Overthrowing a non-Muslim ruler, whether you're trying to change a legislation or whether you're trying to raise awareness, you're saying protesting is always going to fail because of this last one.
The last one is for everywhere.
Okay, here's a question then. You've just connected things to protesting, like free mixing, like missing the salawat. You've connected these things to protesting. I'm saying, what if there's a protest? This is not a ruling for protesting in and of itself. You have a protest that takes place between Fajr and Dhuhr. No salah is being missed. It is segregated. Just brothers come to protest, no one else. Is this permissible or not?
If my reasoning for saying that there's an opposition in it was only that reason, there's many reasons.
Okay, go on. There's no robbing the stores, there's no breaking down, it's a peaceful protest.
Okay.
What's wrong with that?
It's first of all, as-saddu an dhikri Allahi wa an salah. It prevents the people from the remembrance of Allah, because people chant. Each one, let me go through it.
Okay, let's go through each one. You want to challenge each one, or you want to go through to the end and then I'll start bringing my challenges?
Let me mention the biggest reasons.
Okay, bring the biggest.
The first one is taqriru mabadi al-kufriya. You're affirming like one of the strongest branches of democracy. Democracy stands on protest. This is a democratical system. If people don't demonstrate and people don't vote and people, democracy crumbles. This is what democracy is about. Voting, demonstration, protesting, all these things are the branches, usul, that democracy stands on. So by not doing these things, by not voting, by not, people will destroy democracy. Democracy will go out of the window.
You're not going to destroy democracy in a non-Muslim land where you're a very minute percentage. The Muslims are a very small percentage. By you not protesting, you haven't destroyed democracy. All you've done is bring more harm onto yourself, because the government have said, if you want us to change something, this is the way you do it. And guess what we've done? We've sat at home. We haven't changed anything.
I already told you before. Allah says, يَا يَلَّذِينَ عَمَنُوا اسْبِرُوا وَصَابِرُوا وَرَابِطُوا وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. فَلَح. Success, we're already being told it.
And I agree that we should do that. You know, what you mentioned for the first 2 hours.
But I'm not gonna take a path I know it's corrupt. And the means, I just told you right now, what's happening here? This means that I'm taking right now, it's got mafasid connected to it. As-saddu an dhikri Allah wa an salah. Ikhtilatu ar-rijali bin nisa.
I just said a protest, there's no free mixing. I want to get to the issue of protesting itself in and of itself.
Oh, no, that's my point. You see, in the Sharia, so some things, in and within itself, it hasn't got a ruling because demonstration itself, غير منطبط.
Okay.
It's all over the place. I'll give you an example. Traveling right now.
Mm.
Traveling.
Mm-hmm.
What's the reason why we can have rukhsa? Why can we fast in the month of Ramadan when we're travelers?
Because the Prophet said,
because the fasting itself. Sorry, because it's the traveling itself.
Okay.
You can't say mashaqqa. You can't say means, yani hardship. Because hardship is غير منضبط. It's not something you can, a guy can say, look, I traveled and I never felt like I traveled. Mm. Like I was sleeping, I was picking up, you know, by my bed.
But he has an option to carry on fasting. No, because he hasn't felt that hardship.
No, pay attention, yeah. A person's a traveler.
Yeah.
Traveling,
mm.
What's the reason why traveling you can break your fast?
You're saying it's not hardship.
No, why? Why can a person who's traveling break their fast? What's the illah? What's the illah reason?
Okay, what is it? The traveling itself, you're saying.
So here we're speaking very in an usuli perspective. A person is a traveler.
Mm.
A person is a traveler and they are traveling. You said that person, he can break his fast. He doesn't have to fast.
Yeah, that's the option.
He can combine between the prayers, right?
Correct.
He can shorten the prayers.
Yeah.
This rukhsa, was he given it? Why was he given it to him? Why he was given?
Because he's traveling. You see, and with traveling, there is hardship.
So my point is that the issue of hardship, the reason it cannot be hardship, the reason why the hardship cannot be the reasoning,
why,
is because someone who's traveling, that reason might be lifted from them. He might say, I travel.
Yeah, but it's a general principle and most people who travel do feel hardship.
But what about if he doesn't feel it?
Then he has a choice to carry on fasting.
No, but it's not choice, but he's that option, why is it given to him? He's not even gone through any hardship.
Okay, I see.
One brother can say, I was sleeping, I was picking up, I'm a heavy sleeper. My family just threw me into the car while sleeping. I was tired, I was sleeping. Then I went on the private jet that my family owned.
I see your point. We got the option is given to him, not because of hardship.
Another guy goes, I work in the tannur, I work in the furnace. I make bread. يعني, في نهاري رمضان, I'm burning. We say, yeah, no problem. You still have to fast.
Yeah, I see.
Okay. The reason is because this issue of mashaqqa is غير منضبط.
Mashaqqa means hardship.
Hardship is غير منضبط. It's something that cannot be, we can't narrow it down. Mudaharat is like that. So the reasoning for it comes from outside.
Hardship is something intangible because some person might say it's subjective. I'm feeling hardship. I get it. But how is protesting subjective?
As I said to you, the situations change from one situation to another situation. It could be striking, it could be non-striking, and it could be. What can't be stopped from protest is that it's not something in and within itself. It's always external reasons that the prohibition comes from. The prohibition for it is the mafasid that are with it. And our religion is what? دَرْءُ الْمَفَاسِدِ مُقَدَّمٌ عَلَى جَلْبِ الْمَصَالِحِ. Repelling the harm takes precedence over bringing any good. You're telling me you want to bring good for the country, the people. Repel the harm. And we've got all of these harms. Now you have an argument which is strong now, which is, or anybody who believes protest is allowed, if now these 13 harms I mentioned,
they go away.
No, they're still there. But a greater harm is outstanding now.
Okay.
Like for example, the government said.
But before we get there, you're saying that these harms can never go away.
Not all of them. Some of them can be
because
removed.
Because of the democracy issue. You
can remove one or two or three out of the places. I'm saying to you, in the totality, I only mentioned 13. I'm sure if we sit down and we think more about it, we can be hundreds of reasons why mudaharat is not allowed. Hundreds, wouldn't be a problem. But what the question is that some of them are present, some of them are not present. Sometimes it's here, sometimes it's there. The point I'm trying to say to you, you can't deny. I can, this is the real, I've sifted through the arguments.
Mm.
And I'm saying this is the strongest one, which is, التَّعْلِيلُ بِأَنَّهَا لَا تَخْلُمْ مِنْ مُخَالَفَاتِ وَأَنَّهَا يَتَرَتَّبُ عَلَيْهَا مَفَاسِدِ. I've yet to hear about a protest that people went, that things didn't go wrong. Who's controlling it? Who are the people going to listen to? There's no idara or organization. People will know it.
It just seems like a weak argument because you're saying the protests in and of themselves, I can't say that's wrong. It's because of everything connected to it.
Mm.
Like I just feel like, can you have a protest with none of these things connected to it? In which case you'd have to say it's mubah, it's permissible.
Yeah, but I'm saying a person can give you an ideal situation of mudaharat. But I say that's in the mind of the person.
Yeah. But that means that you can't place a ruling on protesting. You place a ruling on free mixing. You place a ruling on missing your salah. You can place rulings on these
which
things, but don't place a ruling
which
on
which are sifatu la yanfaku anha.
No, that's not fair because we can have an idealistic situation.
Okay, give me a situation where all
I'm not saying it's happened.
Right, people waste their time.
Not necessarily, because you're doing for a maslaha. You're trying from to change. Homosexuality being taught in schools, for example, that's a good thing. It's not a waste of time.
Okay, people, do they get, yani, from these protests, do these mujrimeen and criminals come and always try to? Yani, even Black Lives Matter, if you look at the protest that was going on, a lot of people were crying and screaming. I've been following these things. You see, a lot of people were screaming, please don't let some people hijack our mission.
Mm.
We've got an aim. We've got an objective. Shahid, you're in the West. How can you segregate people in protest? How? Where did you get this from?
Mm.
The people, the government will be like, what are you doing?
You can't have a peaceful protest. There's always going to be people who come along.
I'm saying, I'm not also saying. Sometimes it can be, yani, it can happen that no bloodshed happens.
Yeah.
But the other mafasid are always there. You're telling me in London, you're going to have a protest and a demonstration where men and women are not freemixing. I don't know how that's going to happen. Mm. I don't know. Okay, what about leaving off what the Sharia actually did sanction for us, like an-nasiha wa du'a wa sabah?
You can do that as well. There's a sa'a wa sa'a. You can do that in this hour and you can do that in another
hour. But the Sharia chose that. And what about ikhtilalul amri? What are the safety going slightly? People fearing now, getting scared.
Again, it goes back to a peaceful protest instead of a violent protest.
I remember, subhanAllah, watching what happened in Egypt when the protest took place. Women were crying and getting raped. They got raped, gang raped by men.
Yeah, but there's a peaceful protest like Gandhi when he protested against the British.
Did you question everybody who was there who felt some people might have got bullied?
No, did you?
And I'm saying to you that, but I know it doesn't detach itself from it. I'm seeing 99.9% cases where women feel like they got touched by somebody from behind, or somebody pushed her over, or say,
let them stay at home. Let the men protest. I'm saying there is a way that we can say a protest is halal. It's not like alcohol.
But
it's not like we can say this.
Why would you tell the sisters to stay at home if you need their numbers in the first place? You need their numbers, right? For the whole point of the demonstration is the numbers. So if you tell the sisters to stay at home, and they're the majority, by the way, they're the most. Shahid, you see my point? It's a demonstration. The best argument for it is not that it's bid'ah, not that it's tashabbuh bil kufar, I don't think it's not strong enough.
Okay.
The strongest argument to say it's muharram is بِأَنَّهَا لَا تَخْلُو مِنْ مُخَالَفَةِ, that there is one way or another a harm that's going to be present in that protest.
Give me a harm that is connected to the protest in and of itself.
I mentioned that مُخَالَفَةُ دَعْوَةِ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ, يعني it goes against, especially da'wah to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His da'wah stood upon what? عَلَىٰ إِصْلَاحِ الرَّعِيَّةِ الَّتِي هِيَ طَرِيقٌ طَبِيعِي. Starting from the people and making your way up.
Yeah, you can do that as well. I'm saying you can do that, but also we can protest. You have to show me it's impermissible to protest.
No, you can't do that. That sense, protest does go against where the way that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was. For example, the protest, what is it doing? It's speaking to the leader. Fix this, or this problem won't be fixed. That's what you're trying to say.
Non-Muslim,
right?
Leader. We're talking about non-Muslim.
Yeah, whatever
country.
Leader it is.
Yeah.
You're speaking to a leader and you're requesting that leader to rectify the situation, and you're saying it'll trickle down.
Yeah.
I'm saying to you that the people, generally speaking, okay, this is a general state, they should believe that the rectification comes from them, not the leader. The leader's just, he could be sitting in that seat and the people could reach.
Yeah, but this is just an action they're taking. The ada of the Prophet ﷺ and the companions at the time was not to protest. That was their custom. That was their norm. In the 21st century, we live in non-Muslim lands where protesting does raise awareness. I'll quote you the civil rights movement, for example, in America. An entire nation, entire legislation was changed because it started from protesting.
Mm-hmm.
We might not agree with the feminism movement, but they ultimately did make progress through protesting. These are ways that people change. You can't sit here and tell me that just because the Prophet ﷺ didn't take this means, the ibadah is not connected to protesting in of itself. The ibadah is connected to making better laws for the Muslims in the UK. This is just a means, just like me driving to the masjid. That's not an ibadah within itself. It's just a means to get to the masjid.
Again, I told you before, it is it's strengthening the pillars of democracy. This is allowing something we wish for it to go. You're strengthening it, you're empowering it, you're endorsing it by doing that. I don't want you to always try to push the example away, because the point is that one example may apply on a situation and not on another situation or another street. But what there is always a problem in demonstration. That's all my point is. The poet, he said, Sahib al-Maraqi, he said, وَالشَّأْنُ لَا يُعْتَرَضُ الْبِثَالُ إِذْ قَدْ كَفَ الْفَرْضُ وَالْإِحْتِمَالُ. Every situation, there is always going to be a mafsada present in demonstration, one or the other.
Which is going to be?
All that which you're mentioning to me, that there won't be this problem, I'll make sure the men and women don't free mix, is all hypothetical. It's all in your mind.
But that's how fiqh is.
But we need to work with the waqi' that we see and what's happened in the past. We've not yet seen a protest where there's no free mixing. We've not yet seen that.
It doesn't mean we can't see one in the future. Fiqh is based on theoretical rulings.
I'm saying to you, all of these mafasa, I didn't mention one. I said, for example, فَتْحُ الْمَجَالِ لِلْمُفْسِدِينَ مِنَ الْمُجْرِمِينَ وَالْمُخَرِّبِينَ, opening the doors for corrupt people, criminals, people يعني, who غوغاء. They take this, they use this opportunity. يعني, they like that in numbers in order to commit a crime because they can hide in the people. So they loot, they, you know, they do things. And this is every single protest I've looked at, I've always seen that which I could say haram, 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 haram. Let's not go too far back. Let's look at the last protest that took place that we will know about.
In a non-Muslim country.
Yeah, Western country.
Go on.
The protest for the Black Lives Matter.
Mm.
Okay, it started in Minnesota. People were doing it. A whole entire police station got burned down. Shops were looted. People's shops were, Muslim people's shops were looted. They can't stop it now. It's out of hand. Go on YouTube and watch it. People are begging, please do not hijack what we're trying to represent here. Within that, some people put a spin to it and they started using that protest for some other people that they remembered and things like that. Well, my point is that protest, once it happens, you can't stop it. It was through protest that Uthman radiallahu anhu was killed. You know what I mean? Like, that's how it started. People protested around his house, sieged, the sword was shithered, and he was killed.
Mm. Just, I agree that protests in the past...
Because once it starts, police have to come. Why do police come if there's no if there's safety? Why do they have to bring, their shield and protect? Why is fire always, why throwing things at the police? People lose their composure. So... protest saying it doesn't have mafasid shar'iyya, Islamic mafasid. This is all I'm trying to draw home to you, that this last final reason of there being harm, shar'i harms, is high. Ikhtilalul amni, safety. You think at the beginning, okay, I've got this under control, we've got people, you can't promise because then people are more than you and you don't have a soldiers to pin the people down and take them to the corner and drag them out of the political machine. You don't have that. You're just all assumption.
But just because the likeliness is high, does that mean that we can say this is haram?
In the Sharia. We base things on ghalabatul dhan.
Okay, but watching TV, for example, the asl of watching TV, is it permissible?
Yeah,
you can watch a nature documentary on TV. Is that haram?
Which one?
A nature documentary on TV, for example, is that haram?
From the time of,
It's haram?
No, I'm saying wasting your time is haram.
Okay, but let's just say you're pondering over the creation of Allah.
MashaAllah, may Allah reward you, okay, go outside.
So there's nothing wrong with that. Say you with COVID outside and you want to stay inside.
No, I'm just saying to learn, al-nadiru la hukma lahu. Al-nadiru la hukma lahu. Rare situations don't have a ruling. Giving me obscure, random, minute situation and then trying to make me say yes to something very big. I'm saying to you, we've got demonstration, killing, massacring, the civil rights movement. Look at what happened. How many people died? How many people were killed, were murdered? With that being said, all I'm trying to say here is I want people who are listening to understand. I'm saying that protest is haram because of these mafasid,
which are inevitably going to come unless someone presents like a complete hypothetical scenario, which has never happened in the past, talking about Muslim brothers coming with a small group and no sisters there, and it's between the time of Dhuhr and Asr, so no salawat are missed, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
And I don't think anyone should try to argue and say protesting does not have any mafasid. وَلَا يَتَرَتَّبُ عَلَيْهَا مَفَاسِد. That's just far-fetched, and I think it's not being fair.
Okay,
fine. I think a valid argument.
Yeah, I'm going to come on to that now. So this is the next thing that people say then. Now, if you have a protest and we agree that there is mafasid attached to the protest, which means that it shouldn't be done. Question, if what you're protesting for is a mafsada azima, a greater harm that's coming, say, for example, the UK government want to shut down all the masajid, and now you have a chance to change that legislation through protesting, are you allowed to do it then?
Now, beautiful. So let's look at this issue. Protest is haram.
Okay.
It's a mafsada.
Yeah.
We don't deny that. We say, okay, Because the group of people who say that it's not a mafsada, it's fine, what's wrong with it? It's an issue. We want them, first of all, to come to the conclusion that it's haram, muharram, it's got mafasid, mallahu biha alim. There are tons of mafasid that we can mention. Now we have a greater mafsada, greater than the current one. Yani greater than ikhtilat al-rijal bin nisa, greater than some of that which we mentioned, which is fathul majali lil mufsidin min al-mujrimin wal mukharribin. We have a greater harm than that. Al-Alama Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen at this point, and it's a very strong argument he brought forward, he said it's now in this situation, especially Western governments, they hear your voice through demonstrations. That's the way that the government hears what you have to say. And there's no other way they will listen unless they feel under the pressure that the whole entire community is against them on this issue. So in a situation like that, Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen gave the fatwa, the permissibility that he doesn't see any problem with the Muslims demonstrating in order to, but the harm that's there has to be less than the greater harm that's going to come if they don't protest.
Okay.
Which is what is called irtikabu aqallil mafsadatain. Yani protesting for the lesser of the two harms. Now the lesser harm is what we've mentioned compared to the masajids being closed or يعني قضايا عظيمة for the Muslims. In a situation like that, Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, who's a great scholar of our time, said it's permissible. And I can see that as a valid differences where both parties can, I still hold the opinion that it's not allowed.
Personally, even in that circumstance?
I believe personally it's best to avoid it
okay.
and to leave it and not to go.
Even if the UK government wants to close down the masajid, for example,
I believe
still,
the thing is
the ends don't justify the means.
Yeah, and also it's really hard to actually say that it's going to actually work.
True.
Because the reason I'm going to do this mafsada is that I'm sure that this harm that I'm going to tread on is definitely going to be a result. I don't think, there's no certainty for sure that they're going to listen, and there's no ghalabatul dhan. Also, the number of Muslims are very small, and the people who are against the Muslims are very large, and the government isn't definitely not in any way, shape, or form willing to even consider what the Muslims say. So I don't think it's a working method. If somebody else chooses to take that approach and he feels like it's going to work, I think he's got a great bona fide,
okay.
Undisputed imam of our time, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Uthaymeen, who based it on a very strong usuli perspective to say that it's less of two harms. But I don't think it's my humble opinion. I don't think looking at the way Sheikh sees it and the way that the reality turns out to be, it doesn't change anything. I'll give you a prime example.
Go on.
Black Lives Matter in America right now, the biggest protest they did, that protest went from border to border. It went to countries. I don't think in any way, shape or form that's going to change police brutality towards black people. I mean, I don't want to weaken the effort that was put in, and I don't want to undermine the people's hard work. But I just think some things is just demonstration just seems like a weak way of voicing your opinion. It's like, please take the palm off me. It doesn't.
And when you say that, in my humble opinion, I disagree with Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, for example, it's not necessarily other ulama are on your side as well.
Definitely.
Okay.
I'm not there. I'm not able to go to the evidence myself and disagree with a great imam of our time like that. I'm saying there are other scholars who said otherwise.
In that instance, when someone is trying to identify what is the lesser of two evils, it goes back to the people.
Ulama.
Okay, and we already established.
Even the situation of the masajids, is the threat real? Is it actually a real threat? Or is it just one news outlet release something? And is it actually a real threat? What's the reality of it actually even happening? Or is this guy just saying it just to provoke? Or he just wants a voice and he wants to get a voice for his... Because nowadays, anything you say bad about Muslims, it gives you voice from other communities. So is he actually really going to do it? All of that, Ahlul Ilm are the ones who determine it.
Okay, and your solution for the people who say the scholars who are not in the West don't understand our reality is for the students of knowledge in the West who do understand the reality to take it
back to the ulama.
Okay.
What's weird, it's actually really weird about some people is that they say that, and they say, let's not import. And then the same time they tell you Ibn Uthaymeen permitted demonstration.
They pick and choose when it suits them, basically.
When it suits them, yeah.
Okay, I want to end with a couple of closing questions, okay, to end the podcast. First question is, and I think we've covered this in a lot of detail, so it's more just of a summarized answer. What would you advise the du'at in the West to focus their efforts on?
I will say focus on calling the people to Tawheed, strengthening their bond between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَبَعْدُ فَالتَّوْحِيدُ عِلْمٌ يَنْبُلُ عَلَى الْعُلُومِ كُلِّهَا وَيَفْضُلُ قَدْ أَوْجَبَ الرَّحْمَنُ مِنْهُ قَدْرًا لَيْسَ يَصِحُ الدِّينُ حَتَّى يُدْرَى. Tawheed is the most important science or the most important knowledge that a person has to have. Allah says, فَعَلَّمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ. This ayah is a Madani ayah, by the way. It came down in Medina, meaning the Messenger was instructed to say, to know لا إله إلا الله after 13 years of calling to it.
Wow.
So you're, as a Muslim, you can never say, I know it's enough. Yani you always need to study Tawheed and learn it. أول واجب على العبيد معرفة الرحمن بالتوحيد. يعني knowing Allah with His oneness. And this is what all prophets call to. يعني what all prophets had in common from the time of Nuh عليه السلام إلى نبي الله محمد. The one thing they all had in common which was يا قوم اعبدوا الله ما لكم من إله غيره. Worship Allah alone, you have no one else. There's no one else you should be worshipping besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, وَذْكُرْ أَخَا عَادٍ إِذْ أَنْذَرَ قَوْمَهُ بِالْأَحْقَافِ وَقَدْ خَلَتِ النُّذُرُ مِنْ بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا اللَّهَ. Allah says, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ يَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتَ. Allah says, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا وَلَقَدْ Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَاعْبُدُونِ. Also Allah said in another ayah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلْ تَعَالَوْا إِلَى كَلِمَةٍ سَوَاءٍ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ أَلَّا نَعْبُدَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Allah says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهِ. Allah said in another ayah, وَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. يعني if you look at the nusus of the Quran, all of it, and you ponder over it, this message of worshipping Allah and singling Him in worship is something, يعني the whole entire Quran, either يعني صريح or يعني direct or indirect is pointing out. And it's the first command. If you open the Quran from Surah Al-Fatiha and Baqarah, you go, the first Amr Allah commands is, Ya ayyuhan nasu ubudu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum alladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqun. The first prohibition is, فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Do not associate partners with Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. ثلث القرآن, one third of the Quran is Surah Al-Ikhlas, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَد, which is singling Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in worship. أعظم آية في كتاب الله. The greatest verse in the Quran is آية الكرسي, الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم. So it's the concept of a tawheed. And that is the same thing that we sadly recently saw, that it was that same thing that people who we would thought could have preached to the people this concept and strengthened it in the people's heart, they fell short on the issue of a tawheed. So in no way, shape or form are we now going to say, and I hope no one says that, that we know enough about tawheed, because wallahi, I'm shocked, because taking a cup of water and pouring it somewhere, it's something we know from our country, our culture, that this Kitab al-Tawheed is mentioned in there. It's these small things. I'm shocked that Muslims today are saying, I never knew this was an act of worship. Yani, these issues are there in books that people are now saying, why do I need to study it? Now people are seeing it, you see? This is why you need to know Tawheed. This is because you keep thinking that this is not an act of, yani, a lot of youngsters, even on the streets, who think, oh, I didn't know that was an act of shirk. Oh, I didn't know saying that was shirk.
Is like swearing by other than Allah, for example.
Well, a lot of things that people are saying, that if they just study Tawheed, yani, RIP, rest in peace, to a non-Muslim, is a concept that's spoken about in Kitab Tawheed. So, Muslims should take time out and study Tawheed. The du'at should make that their mission, calling the people to a Tawheed and strengthening that concept in the people's hearts. And I think if that is done, and then a Sunnah, calling the people to the Sunnah of the Prophet والسلام, and making sure that they hold on to the Sunnah, and success is there, wallahi. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the Prophet said, تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ شَيْئَيْنِ, I have left with you two things. مَا إِن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِمَا, as long as you hold on to these two things, لَن تَضِلُّ بَعْدِي, you'll never be misguided. Problems won't come. Kitab Allah wa sunnati, the book of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and the sunnah of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. I also encourage the people to go back to the ulama. These issues of serious issues that we're facing in the West, take it to the ulama. Wallahi, go back to the people of knowledge. Allah trusted the ulama with his religion. Shahid Allahu annahu la ilaha illa huwa wal malaikatu wa ulul ilmi qa'iman bil qist. Imagine Allah used the ulama as a witness for Tawheed. Allah says, I am the only one who's worthy of worship, and my witness for them, for me, is the angels and the right and the scholars. Allah used them as a witness in the most important thing, which is what?
At-tawheed.
Allah trusted them with the religion, and He said to the people, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ ذِكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Go to the people of knowledge if you don't know. How can we not trust them with our worldly affairs? Go back to the scholars, consult them. Wallahi, they are nasih. The scholars are the most sincerest of people. Wallahi. وَلِذَلِكَ جَرِيرِ بْنَ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ الْبَجَلِي, the great Sahabi, the noble companion, when Mughirah ibn Shu'bah passed away and he died, and he stood up for حَمِدَ اللَّهُ وَأَثْنَى عَلِيهِ, he said, إِنَّ الْحَمْدِ لِلَّهِ, and then he praised Allah تبارك أَمَّا بَعْدُ, he said. And then he said, بَيَعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمَ, I took a pledge of allegiance with the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. I gave bay'ah to the Prophet. And the bay'ah that I gave to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was based upon what? وَالنُصْحُ لِكُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ, that I'm a sincere advisor for everybody. He said, your Amir that just died, Mughirah ibn Shu'bah, he was the leader of the Muslims for them, and was the governor. Mughirah, who just passed away, كان يحب العفو, he loved forgiveness. Ask forgiveness for him, you know. He then concluded his sermon, Jarir, and he came down. Why did he do it there particularly? Because one leader goes, another leader is going to come in. Sometimes what happens is, you know, safety goes and people start to, you know, he's just reminding them, fear Allah. So Jarir is a Sahabi. Ulama are always like that. They are nasih, they're sincere advisors to the people. They want the best for the people. Cutting the people off from the scholars is bringing an extra problem already what the Muslims are suffering from, when they're most in need of the ulama and the people of knowledge. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He tells us in the Quran, أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا أَنَّا نَأْتِي الْأَرْضَ نَنْقُصُهَا مِنْ أَطْرَافِهَا. And Allah is saying, we destroy from the earth, we take from the earth, Allah reduces from the earth. The Mufassirin, what did they say, mention of the, regarding this verse? Taking from the earth means taking from the people of knowledge. The people of knowledge are like, for the people, like the star is for the sky. Star, Allah mentioned three benefits for it. Allah mentions رُجُومَ لِلشَّيَاطِينَ, shoots the shayateen. The ulama are a thorn in the neck of the shayateen. The third thing that the scholars are for the people is, the second, which the stars are for the sky, is وَلَقَدْ زَيَّنَّ السَّمَاءَ الدُّنْيَا بِمَصَابِحَ, Allah beautified with the sky. And the stars are beautification. The ulama are a beauty on this earth. If you go to the circles and you look how they're teaching and the way that they are sitting and the way that they're educating the ummah, it's a beauty. Imagine trying to take the scholars away from that and taking them to places where the sheikh is sandwiched by a woman on one side and another woman on the other side, and he's running after a woman and with a paper, and he's taking this and he's been, and you've got 5 minutes to say what you have to say, and humiliated like that, where he's got, where he talks and no one speaks back to him. He's respected in that halaqah. يعني,
the third thing.
And the third, fawaid Allah tabarak wa ta'ala mentioned for the sky is that it's a guidance. That it guides the people in the times of, يعني, some people use the stars as a means of guidance to know what direction the Qibla is, where that land is. And the ulama mentioned, the scholars are like that. Scholars are all three of those.
That's beautiful. I've never heard that before. I think it's a very nice place to end. Ustaz Rahman Hassan, jazakallah khairan for joining me once again on the hot seat. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.